month ago, U.S. Air Force Secretary Deborah Lee James told Sputnik regarding the 50 to 70 B-61 tactical gravity nuclear bomb stored at Incirlik Air Base in Turkey, "We do have nuclear weapons, and those nuclear weapons are safe and secure, and we are confident in that." Now, Debka is reporting, the United States has begun secretly evacuating the tactical nuclear weapons it had stockpiled at the southern Turkish airbase of Incirlik and is transporting them to U.S. bases in Romania. Is this a reaction to the failed coup, or is there a larger strategy at play here? As this reaction finally comes after the worst foreign policy administration in U.S. history remained quiet as power was cut to the Incirlik airbase and was put on lockdown while hordes of Turkish protesters gathered outside the base over the purported CIA link to the recent coup attempt, a link that winds its way back to Fethullah Gulen and his movement, the same Gulen who is protected by the Obama administration and maintains a charter school empire in the United States that has angered labor unions while siphoning money from the American taxpayers through those charter schools to fund his movement. The results of the failed coup in Ankara, Turkey, that claimed 294 lives and saw thousands arrested, has awarded President Erdogan unlimited dictatorial control over his country. The New York Times reported Turkey said on Wednesday that it would empty its prisons of tens of thousands of criminals to make room for the wave of journalists, teachers, lawyers, and judges rounded up in connection with last month's failed coup. Numerous sources are now confirming that the Incirlik nukes are being moved to the Develu Air Base in Romania. Meanwhile, 2,000 NATO troops have conducted airborne training operations in Poland, while Obama pledged 1,000 extra troops to Poland. Russian President Vladimir Putin is urging Erdogan to pick a side as the proxy situation in Ukraine, funded by the United States.
"We've invested over $5 billion to assist Ukraine in these and other goals that will ensure a secure and prosperous and democratic Ukraine."
Is it possible that the majority of the civilian casualties that you're talking about were actually civilian casualties that were the victims of the Ukrainian army and the oligarch that financed one-third of their army at one point? Is that possible?
If I could say two things. First, I think it's highly unlikely on the basis of the reports that we've received from the United Nations and from the OSCE. Second, I want to underscore again why this conflict started. It started because Russia moved troops weapons and so forth into Eastern
Ukraine. Just so you know, Madam Secretary, the Russians would suggest it started when there was a violent overthrow of an elected government.
Right. I don't make it a point of listening to President Putin's claims as a general rule. I don't find them credible.
Well, I think that if you are our representative, you should pay attention to everybody's claims, and you should refute them if they can be refuted rather than dismissing them.
And quarterbacked by George Soros, an escalation now forcing Putin's hand as 40,000 Russian troops are now sitting on the Ukraine's eastern border. Our media and government should be working to de-escalate this nuclear powder keg with rational reporting and diplomacy. However, Obama golfs, Hillary thumbs her nose at Putin, and George Soros sways public opinion to lead the world to the razor's edge of World War III, just in time to hijack the U.S. presidential election. John Bound for InfoWars.com.
Powerful report. If you want to share it, it's posted on InfoWars.com. World War III ramps up in time to hijack the election. We've had nuclear weapons now for 65, almost 70 years. We haven't had a nuclear war yet, so a lot of people think it's impossible, even though most top analysts say that it's more probable now than ever and is basically unsurvivable for the human race. But we've got generations of people that have not been in a major war that kills tens of millions of people, so they think they're immune from it. World War II killed more than 65 million people. But Americans think it can't happen here. Big broadcast lined up today. Strap yourselves in. I'm Alex Jones. Waging war on corruption, crashing the lies and disinformation. Monday through Friday from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. Central. Then we have the nightly news, 7 o'clock Central, and I return, as I did last night, 4 to 6 p.m. Central with the Sunday Global Edition. Where to begin? Southern Command, we told you about this 2 years ago, but now it's mainstream news, warns of Sunni, that means Al-Qaeda, ISIS, infiltrating from the South. It's ongoing. Bill Gertz is reporting. We're also going to be getting into Trump leads Clinton in latest poll after a month of trailing. But that's with a poll that still is basically stilted if you look at the methodology against Trump. Assassination attempt. Panic for Julian Assange as intruder scales Ecuadorian embassy in the dead of night going towards his window. Narrowly escapes the security forces. Isn't that just special? And massive news on attempts to censor the free press. This all ties into that. I have a whole stack on that issue that is now really rearing its festering head. Hillary voter registration fraud caught on camera. Paul Joseph Watson wrote a story, and we have the video of a Democratic Party staffer caught on camera violating Nevada election law by soliciting votes for Hillary Clinton right out front the polling place. Also, we're going to be getting into Louisiana man calls out Black Lives Matter for not helping flood victims. Where's the Black Lives Matter boat? There's plenty of Salvation Army boats and Christians of all colors out there helping their fellow humans, but doesn't matter. Obama has put out a memo saying make sure there's no racism in Louisiana in the aid delivery, even though he's not rendering any aid and even though he's on vacation, or I guess ended his vacation last night. Hillary's not coming either. But it doesn't matter. NPR and CNN, I played the clips yesterday. They're very upset with Trump for going. It's bad. It's good to not go. It's bad to go. Unless you're George Bush, then it's bad to go and render aid. But he didn't do it right. It's just best to do nothing. That's liberal. That's trendy. And issue an anti-racism memo, and you've handled everything. Total and complete disconnect. We're going to be going over all these videos today. Also, another video, leftists support blacks only 10% tax reduction, so a form of reparations. This just shows what's going on with the poor Californians. Also, Trump crowd chants, do your job at CNN crew. People asked a few weeks ago, why did Drudge link to a short video of someone saying, you're a traitor, I'm a patriot, you're a traitor, I'm a patriot, at Trump rally to CNN? To start a movement to call out the whore media. Now, Drudge didn't tell me that. I'm kind of synced up just on common sense wavelength. And now this is happening everywhere as people turn their anger on to mainstream media, CNN being chief amongst them. This is the traitor media, the Decepticon media, the collaborator media. And I don't want any violence against them. But it's time to understand that they need to be called out. People don't need to just let them sit there and play along like they're objective when they're such deceivers. MSNBC. CNN, ABC, NBC, any of these groups, if they're out in public at an event, have your voice be heard. How many times have I personally hijacked live TV programs of Fox News, CNN, MSNBC? I've been arrested for doing it in New York. They're outside. I bring a protest to protest the fact that they're covering up the lie that got us into the Iraq war. I just go after injustice. It's that simple. And of course, MSNBC, famously in Denver, attacked me, cut the wire of my bullhorn because the police wouldn't violate my free speech and take the bullhorn away, so they physically attacked us. We just went and got another bullhorn out of the truck and absolutely defeated them. So that's what this is all about, going after the media so they just can't sit there with their audiences and deceive them, because we're going to be jumping in live on air any chance we can to culturally jam their operations. So that's coming up as well. Bill Gates' net worth hits a record $90 billion. That's not counting the $100 billion or so that he and his wife have put tax-exempt into their foundation. They call him the greatest philanthropist ever. What he did was make his money tax-free. The profit goes to him, and the taxes are zero. But only a mega robber baron is allowed to do that, not you. Only the big mega corporations get to pay zero tax. That's how they operate. That's how they roll. While he and Warren Buffett, his partner in the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, he's put, what, 60-something million in last time I checked. He lobbies for higher taxes on the middle class all day, billing it as higher taxes on rich people. We're going to be breaking that down as well. We have Obama readies one last push for Trans-Pacific Partnership. We also have that tying in to Brexit sparks rush for New Zealand as Immigration inquiries hit record high. Yeah, that's where everybody's evacuating to. After a shakeup with Trump, Clinton campaign keeps wary eye on conspiracy theories. That's the New York Times. When Judicial Watch and WorldNet Daily, the Western Journalism Center, sued to get thousands of pages of documents a few years ago, I keep going back to that because it's a key data dump. When they sued the Clinton Library in Little Rock, they got thousands of pages of documents. And in those documents, some of which they published, it says, anyone that criticizes us will be called a conspiracy theorist or a racist. It doesn't matter if they're liberal, conservative. We never intellectually debate. Instruct the media to say conspiracy theory. And then they go into how the CIA trained them, basically in the 60s, to use that term. That term is from the 60s. It's been declassified. You could say that you don't like, again, the flavor of ice cream, and they'll say it's a conspiracy theory. It is a way to just ignore whatever your view is, whatever your opinion is, and not have a debate. It doesn't work anymore. Just the last week, I have seen more than 20, in fact, we should do a compilation video, medical doctors, sometimes head professors, brain surgeons, neurologists, radiologists, the list goes on, saying Hillary Clinton clearly has serious degraded neurological capacity. I mean, I'm not a brain surgeon or a neurologist, but you can see somebody sitting in a bus stop that their hands are shaking and their head shaking and say, that person's probably got Parkinson's. And if you walk over and ask them, they'll say, yeah, I got Parkinson's or some other neurological disorder. Bill Clinton clearly is starting to get Parkinson's with his hand shaking, and he's clearly on medication to try to control it. But Hillary looks like a bedraggled old shoe on the side of the highway. I mean, I'm sorry. And she looks worse by the day. So we've got all these other new medical doctors coming out talking about it, but the response is to just say it's a conspiracy theory and to say that Trump listens to Breitbart and Alex Jones and Drudge, and so no one can listen to them anymore. Now, before I get into that doctor clip, let's get into Trump taking the gloves off. Trump has come out and said that the Clinton campaign is run by grifters and that Wiener is a perverted sleaze, which is absolutely true. And the Democratic Party at that level are con artist grifters. Remember Acorn, where they would send their undercover reporters into multiple Acorn facilities saying, I'm going to run child sex slaves. And they're like, excellent. Just make sure they pay their taxes. Let us sign you up right now. Because that's what the Democrats do. They run the cocaine. They run the heroin. They run the synthetic drugs. They run the sex slavery. They run it all in the cities they control. And that's why the Democrat cities they control are hellish pits. And it's time to call them out for what they are. Let's go ahead and roll that clip of Donald.
To be honest with you, with the emails and the crimes she committed, she shouldn't even be allowed to run for president.
Mr. Trump, let's talk about her email scandal, because she totally threw Colin Powell under the bus. She was meeting with the FBI, and she said that Colin Powell told her to use her personal email server. So she's blaming it all on him. He was in the Hamptons over the weekend, was asked about it, and he said that is a total lie. He said she was using that email for 1 year before he told her that he had been doing the same thing.
Yeah, well, look, she's a liar. I mean, she lies. She lied about the email. She lied about Colin Powell. I saw that. He was not happy. And it's the whole thing is a scam with them. Everything is a scam, like grifters.
Paul Sperry had a column over the weekend about Uma Abedin and her mom. Evidently, they had a Journal of Muslim Minority Affairs going. It's a journal. She was had a title with the journal. She wrote for this journal. And it, you know what? Basically, their message is as anti-woman as you can get. You understand they were talking about how it's better for a woman to be subservient to a man. It goes on and on and on. And today, the Clinton camp answered and said her name was just on there. She didn't really do anything. She had no formal role, as the exact quote, of the Radical Muslim Journal.
And her mom's the editor, is that right, Brian?
Yeah.
And of course, Khan wrote for a journal to work. Found it.
Of course, that's terrible, and it shouldn't happen, and it's a lie. It's another lie that they tell. But what about the fact that Uma Abedin, who knows every single thing about Hillary Clinton, she knows more about Hillary than Hillary knows, and she's married to a pervert sleaze named Anthony Weiner, who will send anything that he has out over Twitter or any other form of getting it out. I mean, she's married to Anthony Weiner. She knows everything that Hillary Clinton is doing.
Absolutely. Let's go ahead and cut him off there, because I want to add something as we go to break here. When you understand how Wahhabist Sunnis work, the royal houses and the people in charge do whatever they want. And the ruling women live in palaces and have their own sex toys and, you know, their own boyfriends and their own helicopters. And they have long hair and they wear big dresses and they do whatever they want. It's the women in general that are enslaved, and the men are enslaved as well. But the upper ruling classes do whatever they want. So that's why Khan founded a journal to enforce Sharia law in America. So, of course, he works with the Clintons and Abedin. This is how they enslave their own people. It's an oppressive slave system, political Islam. It's a fact. And it's waging war against every other culture, the Shiites, you name it. It is taking over. And so that's why Abedin is such a disgusting, horrible person. She'd be executed in Saudi Arabia. Monday through Friday from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m., we're here live. Did I mention Gary Haven, one of my favorite guests, who was in studio with us last week, is going to be in studio with Steve Quayle in studio for 2 hours. They just did a little tour around the country. We had a camera crew with them going around setting the brush fires, warning folks about the New World Order, including going on the big, you know, national Christian broadcasting channels. And that's a big deal, because one of the biggest audiences out there is on Christian radio and Christian satellite TV. So the fact that Haven and Quayle and others are now going on those channels is a very, very positive thing to warn people about exactly what's really going on. This message of exposing the globalist has gone mainstream. And I don't give ourselves the credit, because I even want the credit. Historically, people need to understand that InfoWars has been at the heart of the resistance. And the only reason I tell you that is so you understand what you've done. Supporting this broadcast, spreading the word, standing up, being ridiculed, going to the PTA, going to your church, calling into talk radio, starting your own blog, handing out copies of films, praying for America to awaken. Everything you've done, the rallies you've gone to, I'm talking about folks that were doing this 50 years ago in some cases that are listening. You know who you are. I want to salute you. In fact, I want to get Red Beckman back on. He's super old, like 90 years old now, Air Force vet, World War II vet. No one knew the Federal Reserve was private when that guy was exposing it 55, 60 years ago. Look how far we've come. And Red Beckman, last time I talked to him last year, is still all there. And again, it's not about giving credit. He wouldn't want the credit. But it shows how far we've come to this point. So people shouldn't get too down, because what we're talking about is now the zeitgeist. It's gone from guys out in the wilderness that nobody was listening to. People think I was out in the wilderness 20-something years ago talking about this. I'd open the phones up and half the callers were saying I was crazy. Well, you try 30, 40 years ago. How about all the callers saying you're crazy and not caring, because you know you're doing the right thing? I'm going to cover news in the next segment and get into the latest on Hillary's health and so much more in a bunch of clips. But first off, since I was mentioning this, here's just a stack that illustrates the type of censorship that's going on right now and how it's ramping up. Because they have to now act like naked tyrants, because they are naked tyrants, and their agenda is being destroyed by the truth. Sunday Express, assassination attempt, panic for Julian Assange as intruder scales Ecuadorian embassy wall. An attempted break-in at the Ecuadorian embassy where WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange is living was foiled this morning. Security was scrambled. He's got to release the intel now. I'm telling you, folks, an airplane's going to crash in the building. Something's going to happen. They've got microwave guns they can cook him with. Security was scrambled at the London building, sparking international concern. Assange was the target of an intruder. A statement was put out by WikiLeaks this morning. It stated 16 minutes ago, at 2:47 a.m., a cat burglar scaled the side window of the Ecuadorian embassy in London, fled after being caught by security. That's where he's been hiding out for years. Now, let's tie that into this next story. New York Times tech columnist calls for Google openly to hide Hillary health info. Talk about racketeering. They won't even list Trump as a political candidate till they got caught doing it. They're doing everything they can to game the statistics. When criminal stuff comes out about her, they bury it. They have daily meetings with Google. Hillary and the White House as well meet with Google more than anyone. That is admitted. And see, they can't hide this now, so they just throw it out in your face. And the UN is handed control of the internet and domain names and taking websites down and copyright control outside of law October 1st under TPP. Oh, but who cares about TPP? Obama said, you down with me? It's all cute and funny, isn't it? So this is all happening right now. Meanwhile, Giuliani comes out, and I said he thinks Hillary looks very, very tired. She looks sick. Yeah, no kidding. And we've got another top doctor you can add to the list that is coming out and saying that she looks like she's got very serious health problems and needs to have an independent panel review her health, just as Dr. Steve Pachinik said here 2 weeks ago. The top doctor at Rutgers University, Professor of Medicine Bob Lahida, said that concerns over Clinton's health are not a conspiracy theory, but Hillary said they were, and that Clinton should be assessed by an impartial panel of physicians. That's what they do when you're being insured for, you know, a large amount of insurance. You don't just go see a nurse and a doctor. A whole panel looks at you. That's if you're, say, getting $50 million of insurance. But not when you're about to be the president of the United States and are falling down and look like you're completely insane. But it's okay, because the New York Times says they're keeping their eye on Trump's conspiracy theories. That means questioning known liars, because they control reality. They're history's actors. Welcome back. We're going to plunge straight back into the news here in just a moment. First off, this broadcast is listener-supported, about 80%. We have some sponsors, obviously, but about 80% of this news organization is funded by the direct sales of high-quality products at InfoWarsStore.com and InfoWarsLife.com. And we have assembled thousands of the very best high-quality items at the lowest prices in many cases, but always competitive, and your purchases at InfoWarsStore.com make our broadcast possible. We are going to get some more of this in a few weeks, but we are going to sell out of this any time now. Living Defense is very hard to source. It is a harmful organism, a cleansing dietary supplement with scores of known herbs and plant extracts that have been used by cultures all over the world to get rid of harmful organisms in the gut, in the stomach, in the body. Living Defense is amazing, and I am personally doing a cleanse with Living Defense right now. This is good for yourself. It's good for your children, good for the whole family, but obviously talk to your healthcare provider before you do it. It's available at InfoWarsLife.com or by calling toll-free 888-253-3139. Now, we have sold out of almost all of my inventory of my 20-plus films that were on DVD. We have a few of my films left, but we're having to collate and look at which specials we can offer right now. So when you get Amerageddon, the new $5 million budget film that's a fictional account of an EMP globalist UN false flag attack, produced by Gary Haven and, of course, Mike Norris, this film is excellent. One copy is $19.95. You can get a second copy for $19.95. Then you get a bottle of Silver Bullet colloidal silver absolutely free when you get two of the films. And then it's great to donate to the library, donate to a school. It's a professional film. It's got a lot of big actors. Myself, I'm in it, playing an evil senator. It's really a powerful film. Fox and Friends said, what happens when government turns against you? Ultimate political thriller. All Americans should prepare for this type of situation. Fox and Friends, here's Alex Jones, had this to say: a powerful tool in the information war to really help wake people up and rally patriots in the cause of freedom and justice. So I would, again, ask people to get the film, support the broadcast, support independent patriot cinema with the film, Amerageddon, the special director Producers Edition. Now, it's actually going to come out still in about another week or two. This is taking time to get finished up in the factories. We got the first installment of the DVDs. They're doing a second run right now that's done on Wednesday. So quite frankly, we might sell out in a few days, but then it'll just be backordered for a week, and then it'll finally hit stores. We are the exclusive place to get it. But if you order right now, we've got that first run in as we speak. You'll be able to get it quicker than other folks because it's very, very popular. People want to have this in their archives. They want to have it in their own personal library. With all the censorship coming in, all the internet control, it's more important than ever to archive the internet, to save films, to have a database of information to wake others up, because this information is only going to get more powerful if they go to the next phase of tyranny and actually try to start curtailing free speech, which don't think they won't try. We're trying to stop them. We're trying to back them off. Then if we're successful, they'll say, okay, there's been somewhat of a world government, but it didn't totally take over like you said. You're discredited. Oh, I thought there wasn't going to be a world government. I thought the world government's goal wasn't planned austerity. It's all being admitted now, and people are ready to hear the truth. So, a lot of specials on the film, Out of the Gates, Armageddon, at InfoWarsStore.com or by calling toll-free 888-253-3139. But you see the censorship of Trump. You see the demonization. You see the attacks. You see the New York Times coming out and saying we've got to shut down this conspiracy culture. It's a globalist conspiracy to set up an unelected planetary government and sign us on to over $2 trillion of fake counterfeit garbage that makes Bernie Madoff look like an angel. George Soros is funding radical Islamicists. They're overthrowing countries. They're starting wars with Russia. These people are out of control like Hitler or the Soviets or something. We have bad megalomaniacs that have hijacked the country. We're fighting back. People are listening. The military is awake. So the globalists are really getting concerned. That's why every video you send out, every DVD you share, every article you share, every podcast stream you share, every YouTube video you share, every video you upload or copy, all of the films I've made, all of the documentaries, all the little news pieces, they're all copyright free. For non-commercial educational purposes, I have to keep a limited copyright or people will take them away and say they belong to them. I've actually had folks try that. Oh, there's no copyright. It's mine. You don't own it now. Doesn't work like that. And we've defeated folks in court, by the way, to prove that. So that's how no good deed goes unpunished. But everyone should be airing my films and other films on Access TV. Everybody should be putting them on YouTube and every other video platform. Everybody should be streaming them on Facebook. Everyone should just be blanketing the web with this stuff so that it's hard for them to censor it. That's the answer. They're trying to game things with computers and actuaries and bots. We have to counter it with human intelligence operating in cyberspace, but also hit the streets physically and show how the George Soros, Hillary hired anti-Trump goons are a bunch of lying trash who are the racists and the idiots. That's just one example. We engage them. We show what happens in Chicago, what happens in LA, what happens in other cities. We show the media lying about who starts the fights. It blows up in their face. They get discredited. They collapse. We just let them lie about stuff. We don't send camera crews out. You don't go out and videotape. You don't upload. As a citizen journalist, they win. We lay down, they win. We fight back, we win. We have history, we have the numbers, we have the truth, we have common sense, we have free market, and yes, ladies and gentlemen, we got God on our side when we do the right thing. But if we just lay down, Thomas Jefferson was once asked, what is the level of tyranny under which man can live? Is there a limit to what tyrants will foist upon the people? And he said, the limit is what good people will put up with. There is no limit. It's like, why would Europe bring in 5 million military-age men, jihadis, 80% military-age men? Why would they engage in all this oppression and raping and killing and craziness? And why would the government arrest people all over Europe that criticized it? Because they want to mount your head on the wall. They don't like you. They have criminal energy. They're allied with anything that'll bring down the West. And if you've gone to third world countries, or you've gone to those, it's always strong men, thugs, that rule over everyone, and 90% of the public is in total squalor. That's done by design to control you so you can be bought for pennies, for just a few rubles, a few shekels, a few euros, a few yuan, a few yen. It's called slavery. And the slave master class is setting up a planetary government right now. And they're so arrogant, they will attempt to foist somebody on the public like Hillary Clinton, despite her criminal past, despite all of her corruption, despite all of her lies, despite her making Libya a failed state by design, despite her claiming that she was in combat like Brian Williams, they still force feed her. That's their arrogance. But another top doctor, concerns over Hillary's health, not a conspiracy theory. Rutgers University professor of medicine says Clinton should be assessed by an impartial panel of physicians. What did Dr. Steve Pachenik, who's headed up entire neurological facilities, what did he say? A panel of impartial neurologists and brain surgeons. That's standard. But it's not happening. Instead, the New York Times says it's a conspiracy theory, and Hillary keeps an eye, like she catches us in the cookie jar, like we're hiding, beavering away out here underground. And the New York Times comes out and says it's time to censor her medical info. Don't let anyone see her falling down or shaking or sitting. No, 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 no. They treat us like children. Here's the New York Times. After a shakeup by Trump, Clinton camp keeps wary eye on conspiracy theorists. And see, they'll take the strongest stuff we talk about and act like, wait till you see this, we caught them. Like they've caught us in something like, they say you need water in the desert. You know, what craziness will they say next? Again, it's all about the arrested development childlike minds of their supporters, where they just strut around in front of them acting like they're in charge and they've got control and they're invincible and they're wonderful. Let's go ahead and play the clip of Professor of Medicine Bob Lahida. Here it is.
This is a very unusual story with Hillary. Two blood clots. She's had this stroke, which is in 2012, where she has a transverse sinus. Very, very rare condition. She hit her head, and they're attributing it to the fact that she hit her head. Then she had a post-concussive syndrome. And if you remember, she was wearing a sunglass at one of the conferences before the Senate, where she had double vision and couldn't see properly. The very fact that she's having these clots and she's had two bouts of thrombosis is disconcerting, to say the least.
So you do think then that the concerns objectively, no matter where your politics are, the concerns about her stamina and her health are justified, because you have a lot in the liberal media saying this is a conspiracy to disqualify her somehow.
I don't think it's a conspiracy. And, you know, you go back to the history of our presidents, and we've had many presidents up until Lyndon Johnson who concealed their health during their campaign. And it had dire effects for our country, going from Kennedy to Roosevelt to Woodrow Wilson, whose wife ran the White House for some time. So we have issues here, and I think both candidates should be very forthcoming and have perhaps an impartial panel of physicians review the data and make that kind of a decision before the Americans go to the polls.
Now notice that's relegated to Fox Business now. Used to that be on regular Fox. They're killing Fox now. When I watch it, as a media person, as a person that runs a news organization, I mean, the average person can see it clearly too, but I can see what's being loaded in the teleprompters. I can tell the people have horrible looks on their faces when they're saying this, because they're not used to just flat out lying to people. And again, a lot of folks up there have been threatened that if you don't start toeing the line for Hillary, you're going to be thrown off the air. And that's what could make Trump, if he's not successful in this election, if he's robbed, start a successful new Fox, because they're killing it on purpose. So that opens a vacuum for something more like Fox News. Not that Fox is perfect, but a lot better, obviously, than CNN. Well, not anymore. Here's Rudolph Giuliani pointing out, hey, she looks sick. She doesn't look well.
Just to point out several signs of illness by her. All you got to do is go online.
Her campaign and a number of people defending her, saying there's nothing factual to the claims about her health, and that's speculation at best.
So go online and put down Hillary Clinton illness. Take a look at the videos for yourself.
And of course, how does the New York Times respond? Because we've been saying Google Hillary Clinton illness. Google Hillary Clinton blood clot, Hillary Clinton brain tumor, Hillary Clinton Parkinson's, Hillary Clinton doctors. And we have the New York Times coming out saying it's time to censor and not let you see what's being said or what's being done. Isn't that just cute? Because they're keeping an eye on things. And they're going to make sure as an adult, because they're the adults, you're the child. No matter how old you are, you can be 100 years old. The New York Times is conscious. They're intellectuals. They know what you're allowed to see. And so they're going to delist things, working with Google. The White House already admits they've been doing this with Google, to just make sure you can't find that stuff. That's not totalitarianism. That's not corruption. That's not a problem. Meanwhile, they're weaponizing the whole race baiting more than ever. And when racist groups of black people beat up whites on basically a daily basis, the media covers it up, which then only exacerbates it more and makes people think that's normal and good to do. Now, if the Ku Klux Klan was running around beating up or shooting or attacking black people out of the clear blue, it should be on the news. It should be wrong. They should be prosecuted. That's not a good thing to do. But see, it's okay because they're trying to foment racial division in, quote, minority groups that make up the broken strategy of all the minorities together making the new majority under the Democratic Party, who formerly ran the KKK and is now just shifting that strategy. And that's why we have Joe Biden, not just Kaine, Hillary's VP pick, but Joe Biden just last year saying whites will be a majority. A minority, whites will be a minority in 2017, and that's a good thing. It wouldn't matter if we made politics about issues and ideas and free market and about better policies and more constitutional policies. But see, they're making it all about race and now saying the minorities are going to vote racially for policies against the minority. The essence of classism and racism. The textbook definition. But it's okay because it's Joe Biden. Let's play that clip.
Not only are Muslim communities, but African communities, Asian communities, Hispanic communities, and the wave still continues. It's not going to stop, nor should we want it to stop. As a matter of fact, it's one of the things I think we can be most proud of. So there's a second thing in that black box, an unrelenting stream of immigration, nonstop. Folks like me who were Caucasian of European descent, for the first time in 2017, will be in an absolute minority in the United States of America. Absolute minority. Fewer than 50% of the people in America.
And most of them elderly.
From then and on will be white European stock. That's not a bad thing. That's a source of our strength.
All right. Now, in Europe, it's even worse, where they say whites are inherently bad. It's good the Muslims are raping our women, you know, the Green Party and all those folks. And women don't wear short skirts. It's your fault. We're going to make you take Sharia classes. It's actually happening so that you can submit. Now, again, they claim it's all colorblind. Martin Luther King. Whites sit there and demilitarize the whole situation. And then the Democrats just flip the script completely over and now turn it into race. And will now base it on racial politics by minorities against whites. But, of course, the minorities really won't get anything in that equation except rhetoric that makes them feel good. I'm going to skip this network break because I want to have time to get to this next clip. And that is Mark Dice. This video is up on Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. Please don't just go watch the video if you're a radio listener. We're also simulcast TV, Infowars.com/show, to find all the free feeds and podcasts and everything right now. Send this out to everyone. Because imagine, they've done studies. Most of the white people in this country today come from white immigrants who got here after slavery was banned. In fact, I should do a video with the actual numbers. But more people, it's a fact, you can just search engine it until I guess Google delists it. More people came into the U.S. after 1867 who were white than had come here before. A larger population came in than was already here. had nothing to do with slavery from Southern Europe, Eastern Europe, Europe, you name it. And it was England at the time, starting in the 1820s, that banned slavery and was attacking ships all over the world and was at war sometimes with more than 10 countries at once to end slavery. But you notice everybody says England invented slavery because England ended slavery. It's upside down world, folks. England was actually attacking U.S. ships at times. That's why the importation of slaves stopped by 1800 or even earlier, because England would attack you. Because of the evil white Christian abolitionists in England that would burn buildings down if you didn't ban it. Now, the Muslims were doing it in dozens of countries till the 1960s. Two Muslim countries still have slavery, but it's okay because it's their culture. You cannot make this stuff up. But again, it's the ignorant, dumbed-down population. So you got Joe Biden spouting all his racist garbage, all his Balkanization, divide-and-conquer garbage. So that minorities, who are the majority now, by the way, most areas, don't call for a piece of the pie, don't call for a level playing field, don't call for their basic rights of due process and free market and things that will make you happy and successful historically. No, no, no. It's your racial identity, and you're going to be represented by your local racial leader and the Democrats that pat you on the head. Which then forces whites into a race-based system to defend themselves. And then the government, like a prison warden, manages the prison with everyone segregated. This is an admitted Roman program, 2,000 plus years old. But the public doesn't read history books, do they? The British called it the Great Game. You might want to look into it. It's how they controlled India. A couple thousand British controlled tens of millions of people with divide and conquer. And you're like, well, Indians all kind of look alike. Well, actually, they don't. It's a diverse country. No, they played different tribes and religions off against each other, and it was the exact same deal. So I know I harp on this. There's a reason we've got weaponized media pushing this and why it's so good that Donald Trump is crashing through all of it, unifying us around religious rights and free market and sovereignty and the right to defense and the right to contract. The Renaissance versus the globalist program that is just a repeat of the Middle Ages. So here it is. Imagine a tax cut. See, not a tax cut for veterans because you went and sacrificed and did something. And no matter what color you are, you went and did it. So you get a break on taxes to go to college. I'm all for that. When you've done something special, when you've put something on the line. But not because you're white, not because you're black. Oh, but remember Bernie Sanders said, white people don't know what it's like. Can we cue that up later? What to be poor? There are massive numbers statistically of whites in the poverty category than blacks. Now, blacks have a higher percentage of poverty, obviously, because it's a lower population. But it's not anywhere near the general number. It is the most crazy statement ever. And everybody knows that. We went out on the street and talked to people, especially black folks, who are like, that's ridiculous. So there's not any poor white people. That's the craziest thing I ever heard. That's ridiculous. But again, this is the attack on common sense. And so you go to people and you say, oh, because someone's black, they're now going to get this. When most of the white people that came to this country have no connection to slavery, and then if you go back to the people that were here, 2% of Southerners, 2% of Southern families had, quote, slaves. So half or more were never even here during this. Then you've got 2% of those that were here, and then now you're supposed to pay reparations, which isn't going to even help anybody. It's all designed to create this wealth redistribution system so that the globalists have us totally dependent. And so people dream of wealth redistribution instead of dreaming of starting their own business. This is how you kill the free market. Let's play part of this Mark Dice report in the control room when she popped in my ear and said, you know, Russia didn't abolish slavery until the 1860s. And that was the czars, who were really German royalty or Hungarian royalty, Transylvanian royalty, if you want to get technical, same family as the House of Windsor. That's a fake name. And I was going to mention Germany, though. Some Austrian-Hungarian province is in Germany, didn't end slavery till 1882, if memory serves. I think it was Bismarck, but we'll look it up. Those were white slaves. In fact, if you had the name Schwartz, it meant slave. Schwarzenegger. It means black, suntan from being outside. But we're going to come back to Daria in a moment, who I would imagine from Russia, most of the people in Russia were serfs, was the name in Russia, slaves. So does she get reparations from Russians today, even though most of them were slaves as well? I mean, it's just the ignorance of the public is unbelievable that only black people were ever slaves, because that's what Hollywood wants you to think. Sharecroppers, indentured servants. It goes on and on. We'll be right back. Penal colonies, Australia. Now, Daria, as an Army veteran in supporting special ops and things like that, and she's been to the Defense Language School, you name it, but she's also born in Russia, and so she helps us do great translations of some of the Russian news here on air. That's her voice you hear. But I was really thinking about going to her to go, Daria, most people, I think it was like 80% or 90%, depending on the period, in Russian history were called serfs, and they lived on the land, they were owned by the nobles. Germany until the 1880s in some of its provinces of the Austrian-Hungarian Empire. People can look, in fact, Google, when was slavery abolished in Germany? And it's the 1880s. When was it abolished in Russia? The 1880s. You tell the average trendy that, they look at you like you are crazy. You ask him where slavery came from. There it is, Emancipation Reform of 1861. Was the first and most important liberal reforms effected during the reign of Emperor Alexander II of Russia. The reform effectively abolished serfdom throughout the Russian Empire. And then you can argue then what came after that, here come the communists. Because the truth was, yes, slavery in the Caribbean was even more brutal than it was here in North America. And they were pretty brutal there in Russia, but not to the level of some of the extreme stuff you saw with the African slave trade, which was based on the Arab slave trade. But that's okay, because they got brown skin. Daria, you wanted to comment on this. Go ahead.
Yes, Alex. So when I was watching the Mark Dice video, that's the first thing that came to my mind. I was like, well, I come from Russia, and they've done away with slavery in 1861 with the Tsar Alexander II. So what am I being responsible for with all the black people in the United States? Or even if I were in Russia, and there are black people in Russia.
You're a racist person. You don't want to pay reparations like Jesse Jackson and Bill Clinton, everybody want you to?
Well, I just want to talk to a black person who would confront me on that and convince me why I should be responsible with my taxes to pay them anything. Like, what is their argument?
Well, again, I have to be fair here. It's the globalists creating divide and conquer that are actually pushing this. It's mainly trendy whites that are actually pushing it, if you research it. But there are some of these globalist, quote, black groups that are out there pushing it. And that's what I want to tell them. I mean, let's say, which of course they didn't, but let's say some great-great-grandfather of mine was involved in something bad like that. Okay, I'm not them. I mean, if my dad was a murderer, which he's not, am I guilty for that? I mean, I'm trying to understand how, under this totalitarianism, it's like if my neighbor robs a bank, do I then go to jail, Daria?
Right. Well, I also wanted to make a point on the fact that white people cannot be poor, supposedly, or don't know what it's like to be poor. In the Soviet Union, 99% of population were equally poor. They were all equal, and they were all poor. And my family, my mother had to work three jobs just to get by. And it was a real tough life. And that's why, you know, she made it her goal in life to have a better life for me and to bring me to sort of this land of opportunities that United States was supposed to be.
How much has it changed since you first got here?
Well, you know, I compare how much United States have changed based on how much military has changed. I joined the military in 2000, and compared to what it is now, it's like day and night. I mean, we're talking about, you know, gay people are allowed to be in the military now. They're wearing high heels, and the standards have become so much lower than what
it's clearly the sabotage. I mean, it's clearly the sabotage.
Yeah, I really.
What about Black Ops? I know you can't talk about it, but you were in some of the most secretive stuff. I mean, have they been able to water that down any?
Well, I believe that the regular special forces in the Army have been watered down a lot, and they have been allowing people, just basically anybody, to enter special forces, and that's just the mainstream special forces.
Thank you, Daria. We'll talk to you more. There you go, though. She's guilty. Let's go out to break with Bernie Sanders, though. Here it is.
When you're white, you don't know what it's like to be living in a ghetto. You don't know what it's like to be poor.
We're live, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for joining us. I'm Alex Jones, your host. For the next 2 hours in studio, we have a real treat. Gary Haven, one of my favorite guests, the producer of Amerageddon, a billionaire, successful entrepreneur here in America, and one of the leading funders of the anti-New World Order movement. And then, of course, we got Steve Quayle, who I've known for 21 years over the phone, in studio with us. And the world's so crazy right now that Steve Quayle normally, who stays out west, out in, Montana and places, has actually been flying around with Gary Haven at the controls of his jet, flying himself around the country, speaking to capacity crowds and going on international television programs. And you guys just met with a federal agent about some really important stuff dealing with Stingray and phones. I personally have had multiple of my phones where people go in and start typing and take it over. I had to get rid of my old phone number before it. And then start calling people and sending databases. And then now people, I know it's happening. This just happened this weekend when someone I know was just sending someone a message. And then it was sending messages back from their phone saying, do you have this particular drug? And so they were sending it from their phone and they could see the message had been sent. I guess to have databases just to set everybody up. Just like the DEA admittedly has their parallel construction where they have total access to the NSA. I've had the former technical director of the NSA on, William Binney, just 2 weeks ago about this. And he said they have all of Hillary's emails. They have everything. And he said that it all goes through that database. They're saving it. And the DEA, the IRS, all have access to it. They go in. And then they basically make up a fake investigation and plant evidence when they want to bust you. So when I say the police aren't our enemy, I mean the local cop changing tires, writing tickets, going to, domestic disputes. It's a terrible job. They're great men and women on average. They're good people. Our local police departments are good on average. But the DEA, the CIA, a lot of the FBI, it's globalist run now. So you want to get into this big subject. We'll do it the next hour. I'm not really teasing it. You just mentioned it, and you guys were debating how far you could go with it when we were talking. So let's talk about that during some of the breaks. Let's get into the people that say there's no threat of nuclear war. Let's get into what's happening in the economy. Let's cover the waterfront with Gary Haven and Steve Quayle. Steve Quayle of stevequayle.com. Steve, it is amazing to have you here with us.
Hey, Alex, this is just a delight. And ladies and gentlemen, for me to come out of Montana, I think Alex put it very succinctly. And the timing of all the events taking place are becoming so problematic, so in our face, that now everything, Alex, you and I used to talk about all the time, still talk about daily for you, daily or weekly when I'm on the radio with you or someone else. But here's the thing. It's in motion. Years ago, we were telling you the day would come when this would be in effect, this would be in effect, and this would be in effect. Now it's all in effect, and people can't deny it. So the urgency, and you rightly picked it up last week when you interviewed me, I have never felt a more urgent time in my spirit. And look, I've been on talk radio 25 years, 9,000 plus hours, interview after interview after interview. But by the time that we're talking about all these things, Alex, we're talking about the headlines. You and I basically spoke into existence years ago. And if I don't know of a better, and this is not flattery, it's just a true statement. I've made the statement, I think the InfoWars journalistic and investigative skills are second to none. And that, again, is what I am just proud to say.
Well, I mean, not me.
You've got an amazing team.
Merkel Thalen, who was in Seattle and moved here a few years ago, does an amazing job, is in touch with all the white hat hackers. He broke with the secret documents that Stingray was listening to everybody, watching everybody, and finally proved it, and that they'd also set up private networks of these and were basically tracking everybody in real time and putting in their own communication system at Homeland Security so they could shut the web off but still be operating with their web. And right. and so the guy deserves a Pulitzer Prize for that.
Absolutely.
I mean, that's the kind of journalist we have, and I will give ourselves the credit. When they know we'll break stuff like that, that is dangerous. But we're willing to do it. And by the grace of God, like Jim Garrison said, we've stayed in the spotlight. I think that's why we've been protected.
Well, absolutely, we've been protected. And Gary has basically put his name, his reputation, his financial blessings on the line. And ladies and gentlemen, again, this is what causes people to come out who have a heart for other people. Alex, it's about people. It's about getting them to the point where they're not going to be cannon fodder. And what you brought up about Stingray, just a little bit of information, is years ago, people couldn't, they wouldn't believe that there were assassination algorithms. They didn't believe that the red list, the blue list, and the green list existed.
And that's now admitted.
That's now admitted.
They admit roundup teams. They admit a civilian inmate labor camps. They even call it re-education camps in the Army manual.
Absolutely. And so now...
re-education camps, the Soviet term.
But those are the people that get to live. What most people are losing track of, that quite candidly, Alex, with the very few mouths out there, or mouthpieces, and the broadcast that's out there, we have lost our country internally at any kind of level that I believe political. Outside of Donald Trump, and here's where, you know, thank you for all the times you've done.
Please don't thank me. Just
yeah, no. Look, I got, let me share this. The thank yous go out there simply because having these guys that are absolutely willing to risk their lives, you just mentioned the guy that deserved a Pulitzer Prize, having Donald Trump saying to the world the things that everyone thinks, but they're too afraid to mention. That's the thing. Fear is the dominant theme, and I believe...
And he's breaking through the fear.
Yep, mm-hmm. Yep. And so the thing is that when you break the hold of fear, people can think. But the networks, obviously, are the greatest neuro-linguistic programming tool ever created.
When you sit in front of the TV of mainstream media, that is a weapon system. You better be conscious. In fact, I'm going to skip this network break, last one today, because I want to give you guys more time, but I want to inject something here. We come from a perspective of stopping the globalists, being honest, shining a light on it like Paul Revere. Some people that are living in total fear think we're being negative or fear-mongering or fear porn because they think they're helpless and we're trying to demoralize them. No. We don't think you're weak like the globalists do. We know the only chance we've got is for you to know, under a new world order with GMO and chemicals and chemtrailing, you're already being killed. The only chance you've got is to stand up and to say no. We want you to know about the re-education camps, the red list, the blue list, the green list, so that we can have a debate about it so they can't pull it off when they try to pull the switch. And now the military and the police are awake to a great extent. We won't be caught flat-footed. We're telling you how bad it is because we believe you'll then take action.
Absolutely. And the greatest survival tool is your brain. The greatest antidote for fear is knowledge that we document. Look, we spend so
much... action.
And action. And the action is where most people think that...
And look at InfoWars. Look at Gary. Look at you. We are about action.
Action. And we're in the studio today to basically say, this is a plea. This is a triune plea to basically get people to understand that you're out of time. Now, look, even like when your car runs out of gasoline, the carburetor still has enough gas to continue on for a short spurt. And what we're trying to do today is give everybody... not a short spurt, but we're trying to refill your tank so you can be active and not sit back.
This is the time for maximum effort.
Absolutely. Gary?
Yeah. Man, I'm on fire, guys. A few years ago, it might have been difficult to get up and stand beside us and what we're doing right now. But it is so obvious. It's so in your face.
Open world government.
Yeah. You know, thanks to Snowden and WikiLeaks, we know they're listening to all of our phone calls. You read the disclaimer in your television set not to say anything because it might be monitored. And yet we sit here and somebody can deny that information is being gathered. It ain't gonna be in our
business. I remember Quayle 20 years ago saying your TV's watching and listening to you, and then engineers came and showed me the Scientific Atlantic boxes were doing it.
Yeah, and the disclaimer is on a box of a number of your television sets. Yeah, there it is. So Trump has done a really great thing. You know, I don't agree with everything he says, but this guy is made it okay to talk about political correctness. He's made it okay to talk about globalism. And I think today we should talk about that a little bit. It is no longer a conspiracy theory to use the word globalist. It is part of our common vernacular.
Americanism, not globalism, will be our credo.
Yeah. Yep. It's a nationalist versus globalist world we're in right now, whether it's Brexit, and they chose wisely, or whether it's Marine Le Pen in France or Podemos in Spain, or here in the United States. Trump is a nationalist. He's standing for American sovereignty, American freedom.
And this is nationalism's last stand.
Yep. Absolutely. Hillary claims she is a globalist. And here's the problem with globalism. They're going to package it as if it's some solution to war, which, by the way, they're creating World War III so that they can solve the problem by having global government. And guys, that's just the Hegelian dialectic. That's the strategy where you create a problem, and then when you provide the solution, you acquire power. That is straight out of the book. In fact, all of the chaos going on right now, the open borders, the importing of unvetted Syrian refugees, who the FBI says up to 10% are radicalized.
It's a classic destabilization program. The Southern Command has come out and warned of Sunni extremists crossing the southern border. That's in the news today on DrudgeReport.com.
Yeah, and, you know, ISIS has been coming across the border. FBI says they're now in all 50 states. You know, they want us to believe that they're incompetent, but they're not. This is a strategy. It's by design because, as Henry Kissinger said, the only way that you can have a one-world government is if you diminish the United States.
Right.
They are deliberately diminishing us, everything from spending our money to where it's never going to be recoverable, the debt's going to be so great, to opening the borders, to the lawlessness that Hillary just got away with literally murder. And Comey says... hey, just because we let her off, don't think we're going to let you off. They blatantly put that in our faces. And you know what? I'm not a subject. I'm a citizen. And I'm an American. And I believe in freedom, but I also believe that that the price of freedom is eternal vigilance.
That's right. And a historical moment is here. I want to ask both of you this. Steve Quayle of stevequayle.com. I mean, folks, I've known this guy 21 years, never met him in person. It's amazing. Here he is. If you're a radio listener, you can go to Infowars.com/show. Some cable systems and TV stations are also picking up large portions of the broadcast now and the nightly news. But here's Steve Quayle in the flesh because we are at such a historic crossroads right now. Steve, going back 20 years ago, 25 years ago when you were writing your books on geoengineering, genetic Armageddon, you name it, now we're here. Now they admit chimeras, cross species. They admit world government. It's basically exactly what the Patriots and the John Birch Society and others told us they were going to do. Because people see this paradox. They go, wait, the government's run by corrupt, evil people, but you're saying the government's one of our greatest hopes. It's people in the military and in some of these agencies that actually know we're telling the truth, that have leaked the info. How did the John Birch Society know the stuff of the 50s and 60s? They had a lot of patriots telling them. That's why it's dead on. And so that's why we can't just have a war with the government in general. We have to have a war with the ideas of the globalists and point out their occupiers in our government, or they will fool us into a civil war. Clearly, they're setting up civil war in Europe and here as you got into the destabilization program. How do we counter that?
Well, we counter it, first of all, by saying, look at the dialectic, which Gary brought up. You know, Hegel said, you create the problem. Everybody knows that. But what's tragic is most people don't understand that the war of the police against the people against the police. Alex, I was told a decade ago that we're talking about simply assassins to provoke the war between the police. Look, we talked about militarization of police, what, 15 years ago?
Then they'll use the cops getting killed as the cover to wipe a bunch of other ones out.
Absolutely. And ladies and gentlemen, it's always control the narrative. Whenever the mass...
And you talk about a list. We know the special lists are on the police.
Yes. And for the record, police, feedback to you, military guys, they've got their wives, where their wives go shopping. They know everything. They're trying to ultimately force the police to be the first line of attack or arrest. And then once they're done with those guys, the blue list is simply this. Police and military that go along with the original roundup and assassination. Everybody focuses on...
Break this down. This has been done in other communist countries under Nazi control. It's an old totalitarian program. Explain how the police are like the garbage men that bring in the garbage. But once they've done that, they're then taken out.
They're then taken out. It's just a fact. The war that's generated is being absolutely orchestrated, and the people that are behind the scenes, we call a hidden hand, the globalists, the Illuminists, the elitists, and truly, Alex, the Satanists, they are implementing all of their predetermined, and I say this, hellish plans. When you and I started on the radio, we were trying to tell people about the events that were in the natural realm. Now, reading the front of Matt Drudge's page, it's like a world of supernatural evil. I heard you use those words the other day.
And speaking of Drudge, he's linked to our story from Fox News. Top doctor concerns over Hillary's health, not a conspiracy theory. We have top university professors, the heads of whole departments, saying clearly she's got neurological problems. And the New York Times says, you know what, just delist those articles. Don't let people see them. I mean, they're nakedly pushing censorship now.
Yeah, they told Google to do that.
What do you make of that?
Well, it's just part of their exercise of control. Guys, we got to realize this. You do not have a free press in this country, with the exception of this internet, which is another problem because the UN very likely going to take this thing over on October 1st. Yeah.
So notice it's all converging.
Well, we have a limited time. And, man, I tell you what, if you can't wake up today with all the evidence in your face, I don't know what's going to wake you up. But when they – and Stephen, I've been talking about this internet takeover. Are they just going to shut it down, or are they going to slowly diminish it?
I think it's
going to
be slow, slow.
And I agree with you on that. And how will it happen? Well, they're going to take something like Islamophobism, okay, when I say something like, you know, it probably not a good idea.
Sharia law is not compatible in a free country.
Yeah. Well, that makes me an Islamophobic.
And by the way, the BBC now said that this weekend.
Yep.
They said shut down websites and arrest people.
Exactly.
That even, and Germany's already doing it.
Yep, exactly.
Absolutely.
You can see the beta test.
Yep.
You can,
and what I think this is critical, identify, vilify, nullify, destroy. They're in the process. It's a formula. I just started radio with. The identification, we're the bad guys. The vilification, we're the bad guys. We being the truth tellers. We being those that go out and say, wait, this is an orchestrated theater of the absurd.
We're the conspiracy theorists.
Yes.
Because we don't believe Hillary.
By the way, and what's interesting is, remember, those who initiate, this is just absolutely right out of Saul Alinsky on steroids. This is going by his book, and who, obviously, Lucifer is his direction. And
that's guidance. Who he pledges to.
Yep,
to.
Yep.
And so, remember, telling the truth in times of deceit is a revolutionary act.
That's right.
Yep. And
how is it going for him, Steve Quayle?
Well,
Harry Haven?
In I'll turn it right over to Gary. In my opinion, it's succeeding at breakneck speed. I want to get to the major crux of the matter on, you mentioned France, you mentioned Germany, obviously England. Alex, everybody's forgetting the first premise of the New World Order. Out with the old and in with the new. The Phoenix is their mascot. They must destroy their countries, their nationalism, their currencies, all their values. They've said that. So what you're seeing in the world, everyone, is you're seeing the actual implementation of the destruction of borders, language, culture in order to introduce all of their designs and plans. And so we're saying we're holding back the dam to the best of our ability. But Alex, there's more leaks springing. And when this thing springs on the American citizens, you can watch everything that's going on in Venezuela to know what the future
is. Let's talk about that, because people say, oh, Alex, don't fearmonger. There's no depression. There are more than 30, 40 countries that are totally collapsed right now. It's unraveling all over the place. And we're just saying we need to fix this situation while the globalists are making it worse. We're going to come back and talk about all this and more with Steve Quayle and Gary Haven. I'm Alex Jones. Stay with us. I talk a lot about this because the lawsuit that happened a few years ago that got tens of thousands of pages from the Clinton Foundation, not their international foundation, but the foundation based in Little Rock at their library, tells you how they operate. And they say, anybody that criticizes us, we call them conspiracy theories. We threaten the mainstream media to never listen to anybody, liberal or conservative, that has a view outside of what we're saying. And we've got to ridicule anybody that starts independent media that ever tries to sell any of their own products, because we control them through the corporate sponsors. If anyone ever starts direct selling, which I figured out before I ever saw it in their memos, that will free them. And then it will create a new independent media and bring back journalism. They use that term, bring back journalism. They knew they'd already killed it by the early 1990s. And so that's why it's symbiotic. We sell books, videos, preparedness items, water filtration systems, non-GMO seeds, at very competitive or sometimes the lowest prices, nutraceuticals. These are things that counter the globalist onslaught. I mean, the media has written big articles. Look, Jones says the government's putting stuff in your water and then sells you a filter to get it out. Absolutely. It's what I do in my house. Yes, exactly. We fund ourselves morally and are independent. Again, they act like it's dirty because we didn't get billions of dollars like NBC and MSNBC and stimulus money. Yes, we're evil. We don't audit you with the IRS and take your money and then use it against you. We just sell products. You can competitively, you know, go out and shop and decide to support this message that you see growing. And that's why I wanted to tell you, I finally had a chance to see the film last week. It is incredible. True Legends, the documentary film series. It's Discovery Channel and beyond quality. The Unholy See, the Vatican knows all the secrets. Look at how the Vatican is pushing all of this. We have this film now available at InfoWarsStore.com. We also have Zeogenetics. Changing men into monsters and what the globalists are trying to do. This huge coffee table book by Steve Quayle. We have the Hillary for Prison shirts. And of course, we have the new $5 million budget fiction film that's a near future dystopia, special director's edition available here exclusively this week. Next week's going to be in stores nationwide. They've stolen our country. It's time to take it back. Armageddon. And this is the director's lengthy cut of the expanded one. Not the one that you're going to be seeing when it's later on TV later this year. It's also still in some theaters around the United States. When you purchase it, it supports Gary Haven and what he did. It supports InfoWars and our entire operation as well. And then finally, one of the nutraceutical supplements that is about to sell out probably today, 20% off on the Parasite Cleanse, Living Defense at InfoWarsLife.com. And please get these films, show these to people in your area. This is how we're winning the information war. Will InfoWars by itself, or Gary Haven making his film, or Steve Quayle by himself fix everything? No, but all of us together, and more media outlets are impossible to shut down. And now globally, we see the anti-New World Order movement winning with the Brexit, having other big victories. We're gaining steam. The globalists are in trouble, but they're accelerating their plan to finish it up, because they know their time is short, to quote the Bible. So again, thank you for your prayers, your support. Don't thank us, because you are the reason we've been able to do this. We're here carrying the ball. And quite frankly, we're all in now. Like Jim Garrison said, you know, they said, why are you still alive exposing the Kennedy assassination? They've killed over 300 people. And he said, because I'm the most vocal. I've already said everything. If they kill me, it highlights everything I've done. And I get that question. Why are you still alive, Steve Quayle?
Hey, man, I've been told that I'm the canary in the mine. You're the canary in the mine. And why aren't you dead? Well, I have a real simple answer to that. Because it's not time, and God's got people praying. You know, Alex, one of the joys of my life has been to see the supernatural hand of God protecting us. We'll never know until we get to heaven how many times God intervened in our lives. And by the way, I just came up with a new name for Armageddon. It's going to be called Haven's Headlines, because I asked Gary and really asked him to pray about it, to release it exclusively through
Haven's Revelation.
Yeah, or Haven's Headlines, okay? Because I said, Gary, I don't know what you didn't cover, but the headlines of the day, all the UN stuff we've been warning about, all the UN images that have been seen across the land, across the internet, we're now seeing, and that's why I love about the timeliness. This is not a natural thing. The releasing of Armageddon and the headlines of the day concerning the UN, and we won't give it away, but the bottom line is it's the story plot. It's the theme.
I mean, Gary invested $5 million in this, and I'm probably guessing at this point haven't gotten it back. But you didn't do this to make money. It'd be okay if you did. You did it to warn people. You did it to put out good, you know, culture that isn't globalist garbage. You put it out as an antidote. You put yourself in the arena.
You know, I didn't make a movie to make money. I made a movie to make a difference. And I think this movie has been fantastic. You know, it's fact-based.
Huge success.
Yep. We tried to include all the content that's in the news every day that are being established against the people. By the way, Steve, if you're the canary in the coal mine, I must be the Gary in the coal mine.
Oh. Okay, touche.
All right, there is so much to get into. Before the break, you guys were talking about a destabilization program. Clearly, I saw this a few years ago, wasn't hard to see, but to actually see them do it is still crazy. Bring in 5 million Muslims, 80% military-age men, know that they were the Sunni invasion force into Syria, advertise for them to come, have the founder of the EU take a demotion and be the head of the refugee program, flood them into the U.S. as well. Then they start attacking, they start killing. We're told we've got to give our speech up. We've got to take Muslim classes. This is now happening in Europe and the U.S., we've got to comply with them. We're bad. And then Europe starts collapsing. Then they reorganize it. They're now saying, we want to get rid of sports team names that are, you know, the Spanish or the French or the English, because that makes all the immigrants upset. The American flag makes people upset. Don't wear it at school. We have to take our culture down for theirs. But that's just the cover for the globalism coming in. Now they're saying the European soccer teams are going to be mythical names. They're not even going to be country names, because that's bad. You can see how they're doing it.
You know, they got rid of the Washington Redskins, or at least you're trying to. What are they going to do with the Oregon State Lady Beavers team?
Well, they're going to destroy all national borders, language, culture. They're going to destroy.
I guess they can spin that as something bad.
Yes. Yes. They're going to do everything they can, Alex, to absolutely destroy any integrity. Look, we knew when the president of the United States wouldn't even put his hand over his heart at the swearing-in ceremony. We knew when he was...
That was a message.
That was a message.
When they put Mateen, the shooter's dad, you know, behind Hillary, it's a message.
It's a message. It was a $375,000 well-paid message, but nevertheless, it was totally psyops. And here's the thing that I want to get across to everyone. They have to understand that what we're doing right now is giving you the last breath of reality-based news. And I'm not so sure that it's all going to be based in the political realm.
And that's what Drudge came here and said last year. He said, next year's it.
Yep, I agree with him. And that's why I think the timing of this, look, I don't know if I'll ever be with you again, but I thank God for this opportunity. You can't take anything.
Well, it shows how late it is that you are here.
Yeah, it shows how late it is. It's that demanding. And it's not.
Drudge hadn't done an interview in years. He popped up here to warn.
Right.
And people better understand that's how serious this is. And I hope we make it, something huge doesn't happen, and I hope we're still here next year. I'm just saying, I'm really concerned. I'd say 50-50 right now.
And I'm a little bit more than that. I'm saying 70-30 against us, because here's the thing. All of the news that's out there, remember, the number one goal of the global elitists, the Satanists, the Luciferians, is to overwhelm us with data, overwhelm us with problems, terrorize us. But you know what? There's a great a scriptural reference. The righteous are as bold as lions. And so the thing is we don't have to sit and cower in fear. And that's what they're counting on, Alex. They're counting on people just fearing and caving in.
Let's talk about real fear. If the globalists ever get their agenda, again, people think that I'm fear-mongering, bringing up real crises. I'm bringing it up to stop it. If I call my neighbor, hey, your house is on fire, it's not to fear-monger. It's so we can get the fire department out there, and I'm telling them. Okay, that's taking action. If I say, hey, your wife's choking, I'm going to do the Heimlich maneuver, it's not fear-mongering, I'm going to save her. I've actually seen people try to stop me saving a woman. That's how they were saying 911, 911. So we're sitting here seeing this unfold. So let's actually tell people, what is the New World Order's real goal? If they win, that's what people should be worried about.
Well, look at every place you go, your own family. 9 out of 10 people are to be destroyed. And that's you've quoted, we can quote ad nauseum everybody who said it, from Jacques Cousteau to Prince Philip. It doesn't matter who you quote.
Ted Turner.
And by the way, Ted Turner said, if there is a heaven, and I'm going to assure him there is, that he's going to go up to God and punch him in the nose. And I told Gary Haven, I'm looking forward to seeing that. I'm looking forward to seeing that when God says, take your best shot, Ted. You know, I mean, that is the epitome of vanity. But here's the thing. Where you're coming to, where I'm coming to, where Gary's come to, is the fact that this is a supernatural evil. And again, Matt Drudge is to be commended, because he's telling people, look, we never have to deal when we started. We never had to deal when we started on broadcast radio with people eating people's faces off, or people chopping up human beings, or Christians absolutely being slaughtered worldwide, and the Muslims in charge don't ever want to talk about that. You see, because that's where the disconnect is. The disconnect is simply that.
And mental illness is exploding.
Mental illness.
Craziness. You see it everywhere.
Demon possession. Demon possession. Jesus cast out demons. You know what happens in the United States nowadays? They welcome them. They give them a political title, and they say, go destroy the country. And
they build statues to them in Oklahoma.
Oh, yeah, amen.
Shorter. Or New York City, which almost happened.
Yeah, so we're dealing with the basis of all this. Hillary Clinton, Saul Alinsky. Obama, Saul Alinsky. And he dedicates his book to Lucifer, okay? And we talk about Luciferians. You were the guy that went out to the Bohemian Grove, made your videos on it, and people still didn't believe it. Now you've got everybody putting their hand over their eye. I'm saying it to describe it. You've got.
Oh, I know. They'll say I'm doing it too.
Yeah. And by the way, you can look at. I don't have slits in my pupils. You know, it's the idea is simply this. Donald Trump, and I, my opinion, is God's prosecuting attorney. He's laying out the evidence, and it's like everything evil is swarming upon him. I think that the fascinating thing about this is that, you know, you probably heard this, but I gave a word that I really felt was an answer to prayer. And God said, before I allow America to be destroyed by the Russians and Chinese, okay, now this is hard to take, I'm going to reveal the sins of America's leaders to the people, and the people's sins before a holy God.
Doesn't that biblically always happen? Before a country goes under judgment, they get warning after warning, and then one really big warning.
I believe the big warning's coming. I believe the ultimate warning is coming. I don't know if it's going to be geophysical. You know, for instance, Tambora, a volcano. People say, what a hypocrite. You live in Montana. You're right on the Yellowstone supervolcano. I can tell everybody this. I told the BBC, get down to the South Pacific, before the Band of Oz.
Well, I was about to say, you were the guy saying 20 years ago, get ready for the Ring of Fire to wake up. It has. The most action ever recorded in modern history.
And we're seeing now climate change. And let me tell you where climate change comes from. In the book Xenogenesis, I have an interview. This is the most critical thing. I told this on Jim Baker's show. By the way, we asked everybody to raise their hand, or those who listen to InfoWars to raise their hand. 99% in the audience at Jim Baker's show raised their hand.
Wow, that's a big show.
That's a big show. So the thing is that in Xenogenesis, I made the statement, I'll make the statement for your audience, the most important information I've ever gotten in 10 years is contained in the book Under the Rainbow. Basically, a dying CIA high-ranking official talked about the chemtrail. And as you know, I broke that story 20-some years ago. But it's more than what people think. It's not just to destroy the food, destroy the atmosphere, destroy us. It's to destroy the balance that God created. The rainbow was God's covenant with man that he wouldn't destroy the earth by a flood. Again, so in Xenogenesis means an addition of the third strand of DNA, which is either alien, fallen angel. When I say alien, I'm talking about genetically altered DNA put into the human genome to do away with...
I was about to say, even if people... I never get into space aliens and things because you can't prove it one way or the other. What I get into is they're creating new species and new DNA and artificial DNA that is alien, not of this world.
That's what I'm
saying. And now they're mixing it with nanotech, so they're now making it silicon-based.
And when you get silicon-based life forms versus, you know, carboniferous life forms...
That's what you've got on the cover of the book.
Yep. And can I hold this up?
Sure.
Yeah. It's really important. It's got three elements in the cover of Xenogenesis. This is done by Duncan Long.
And that's available now at InfoWarsStore.com.
InfoWars.com. But you've got the flying saucer, you've got the baby, and you've got the robotic. We're dealing with transhumanism. We're dealing with stuff that's out of myths.
And in their own words at Bohemian Grove and Skull and Bones, they believe they're channeling from creatures in another dimension, building things that they've been given divine guidance to do. So whether you're a Christian or Satanist, whatever, the atheists are way behind because the elite, like Darwin, channeled this whole vision of DNA and world government and gave it to Galton, who created the eugenics movement, all off of hallucinations that Charles Darwin says he got from entities.
Right.
And by the way, that's not in The Origin of Species, but he wrote letters that are public saying this. This is a fact.
Oh, absolutely. And the transhumanism, you know, George Orwell, they who control the past determine the future. And my statement to just be up one up on Orwell, they who control the past control the future. So the entire exchange, the language of the day is this: God's creation is not good enough. We're going to create an Ubermensch, a Superman, okay? The book that I wrote, which will be available on InfoWars.com, Empire Beneath the Ice. Do you know that even when Dr. Wernher von Braun was interviewed and another very famous German scientist, they basically said it's not that we Germans were smarter than everybody else, but all the information came to us from spiritual sources. In the book, I actually...
And by the way, I'm an expert. I've read hundreds of books on the Nazis. I really researched that when I was in high school and college. And then that's in the Nuremberg trials.
Absolutely.
I mean, they were chopping Germans' heads off and then trying to, like, seance info from them. And we're getting all this technology.
Well, they had technological demons in that they literally... And by the way, this is all provable.
But again, even if people don't believe this, look at Ray Kurzweil. He says, I don't believe in God. I'm going to build one.
Yes.
But we've all got to die first.
Yep.
I mean, it's all directly out of the Bible.
They get to live forever, but we all got to die first. There's something wrong with that.
Yeah, we're going to kill everybody, but then I'm going to let you live forever. But kill them first, then I'll give you the power.
Right. And so what are we seeing? We're seeing...
You're going to be a god. That's Genesis.
That is the book of Genesis.
In fact, it's the original lie.
You know, yep.
Satan went to Eve and said, you can be like God. And by the way, you will not die. And if you think about that, in this current...
And that's the headlines. Why are all the billionaires obsessed with living forever? That's the headline of the Associated Press, because they're into this.
Yeah, and man, they're some ugly dudes. Have you seen a picture of Rockefeller lately or Kissinger?
People ask why they can still be alive, because basically they are human blood-sucking parasites, okay? The Rockefeller Foundation and other foundations they've exploited, if you will, trying to enhance the human genome. But the missing element in this, and this is why, you know, people...
So they founded Cold Springs Harbor, the Rockefellers, and the Kaiser Wilhelm Institute,
right.
And they're over most of the blood products in the U.S. Peter Thiel's come out and says he wants the young and the blood to live forever. I'm not saying he might even be a bad guy, but he's like kind of saying what they're saying in public.
Right, and here's the thing. I talked to a pilot, you'll appreciate this, Gary, that flew into one of the secret laboratories in Virginia someplace, and he said this: as far as you could see, like a football field inside, underground, our laboratories, the number one obsession was enhancing humans, okay? Enhancing what were humans, that's what he said. And the chimeras of production.
Look, listen, they tried to hire my dad in the mid-'80s, $500,000 a year, because he was teaching dental implants at Baylor Medical School.
Wow.
And he was already doing work on, like, high-level CIA people and stuff, you know, just their teeth. Because, you know, that you know he had a clearance or whatever for working at Baylor. And they and my mom wanted to know. And he said, well, it's classified. I can't tell you. This is at the dinner table when I'm, like, 9 years old. And he goes, it's cyborgs. That's all they're going to tell me. But and then my mom said, well, David, is this? He goes, no, they're hiring a bunch of the top oral surgeons. It was a huge industrial program. It wasn't just him. They hired some of his colleagues. Stay there. All right, Steve Quayle is coming back into the studio here in just a moment, here with Gary Haven, maker of the film Armageddon. Now, my dad didn't take the job in Maryland, but he did get an offer to work in a secret physical underground laboratory facility. I remember my mom asking about it. He's like, no, it's underground. And he never actually went up there and got the full tour and whatever the secret stuff was, just because he told me everything he knew about it. But it was just basically, imagine with spies, mm-hmm. being able to graft things into bone, hide things, do things with teeth, basic stuff like that. But here's the bottom line. There is a giant Manhattan Project program, much bigger than Manhattan Project, to extend life for the elite and to not give the general public that, but to also test things on us and to dumb us down. And the elite basically admit they're doing this. And Bill and Melinda Gates lead that project. What can you say about them, Steve Quayle?
Well, here's the thing. Vaccination is the ultimate weapon of destruction. And all those involved, especially Big Pharma and others, has everybody noticed, Alex, everything that comes out that's a new threat biologically is automatically always met with a vaccine that they just happen to have on the back burner. The idea is this. I made the statement, it was on your show, shot in the arm, shot in the head, either way you end up dead. And so
the ultimate soft kill weapon that kills you 10 years later.
Absolutely, and I apologize for this earbud.
We're going to move it over. I think it's too tight.
Okay.
But this, they've been caught adding things to vaccine, the UN and others. Yeah. We know the vaccines don't protect people, and they're trying to set the precedent. Governments that have been caught thousands of times in lethal secret tests, from Tuskegee to you name it, radiating little kids, giving people syphilis, that they want to put something in us because they love us.
Well, and the point is that everything they can do to destroy every barrier, God made us wonderful. He made the human body with such an amazing immune system. A lot of the products that you sell are designed to base the immune system, to build it up. But everything's coming against us. See, here's the bottom line, everyone. They hate human beings. And it's because I don't believe that at a certain point, a lot of these guys have given themselves over, that they become totally possessed. And now what we're seeing is a true outpicturing. We're seeing the true price that these Illuminists pay, even with their health.
So basically, if we look at this from a cosmology, this is what Christians already believe, but from a science fiction cosmology, it's an interdimensional invasion into people, and then they're building the planet they want, the atmosphere they want, the system they want, and getting us ready to be phased out in their final colonization, when these demons merge with silicon that supposedly lives forever.
Absolutely. And, you know, when you've got on the front of, again, major news sources, robot babies being born from robots. But here's the thing. You're talking about demon possessed. A demon, let me just make it real quick, is a disembodied spirit of a former living entity that was alive. I'm sorry, I'm trying to look at green or red.
There's so many cameras. Go ahead. Yeah. You're doing a great job, Steve.
Okay. And the idea is this, a disembodied spirit wants to be embodied. Imagine this, Alex. Imagine such sinister, evil people that they've collected the DNA of everything from Genghis Khan, Kublai Khan, Hitler, Stalin. You name a bad guy in history.
They want to match up with DNA that matches them.
Yep. And also,
it's just like the movie Avatar.
Absolutely. But even one step beyond that, you know, again, this is why, excuse me, I'm going 300 miles an hour. When we're dealing with the fallen angels, the whole thing about that. Now, that's biblical, okay? But now you're getting people coming out and saying that they take orders from a fallen angel. This is amazing. In True Legends, we've got an interview with there we go.
It's okay.
Okay, True Legends. The deal is Tim Alberino in Italy meets with a very wealthy, wealthy gentleman who basically said that Zachariah Sitchin was being instructed, okay, by an Anunnaki. An Anunnaki is another name for fallen angel. It's just in the Babylon.
And let's be clear, whether you believe in this or not, we're just here looking at this as, I guess, anthropologists or sociologists. The elite folks, I don't know any of them that are really atheists. They all believe they are getting instructions from, quote, angels. They admit that's what Skull and Bones does. They worship angels while they sit in big pools of feces. Okay, I mean, you cannot make this up. That's mainstream news. We'll be right back. What type of angel wants you to sit in feces? Billionaire entrepreneur, filmmaker, patriots here. And, of course, we've got one of the original survivalists, one of the original people of the modern wave of exposing the New World Order. That, of course, is Steve Quayle of stevequayle.com. We're carrying his True Legends, The Unholy Sea, at InfoWarsStore.com. We're carrying Amerigeddon exclusively right now. It's going to be in stores around the country next week. Was delayed, so I'm glad we have an extra week to be the exclusive purveyor of it. And you can also get a free bottle of colloidal silver when you get a second DVD of Amerigeddon. Xenogenesis, the book, is also available at InfoWarsStore.com. Now, a long segment's coming up. You said you want to get into the threat of World War III, but I want to get back into the basic cosmology of the globalist. I've been on air 21 years. You've been on air 25 years. I never touch UFOs and stuff because, quite frankly, I can't prove it one way or the other. Congress admits FEMA camps. People won't even admit that's real. They won't even admit Hillary's got a health problem, so I don't go there. But I can really say, as a deep researcher of history and the globalists, when you mentioned the Nazis being into the occult, saying we're getting this information from spirits, Skull and Bones, all of this, Ted Turner, who wants to go punch God in the nose, you'll hear they're atheists on the news, and then you actually go read their real writings and statements. They believe they're getting knowledge from these good spirit guides of these angels. Well, the Bible says all of this and warns people, and now what the Bible said is happening. But the main churches just say, oh, rejoice, God's about to come back. Well, I thought we're supposed to oppose this evil. What do you say about that, Gary?
Steve's taught me a lot about this. You know, there's no aliens, there's demons. And Steve has a great explanation. He's taught me about this, you know, where these demons come from. And we know that fallen angels rebelled against God, came to this earth, and we know that they had sex with human women. And we know that the offspring were these entities that Steve will talk about.
That's in the Bible.
Yeah, it's all biblical.
And that's why the elites try to intermarry, is to keep that bloodline, right?
Absolutely.
Well, the idea is Satan knew that if he could contaminate the human DNA, he could prevent the coming of Jesus, because Jesus had to be of pure DNA. And a lot of the Bible, a lot of the really awful things that happened, entire cities
just wiping out the bad guys,
was to cleanse the DNA so that Jesus, Satan could not prevent Jesus from coming. And I see what's interesting about this conversation right now is my goal, and I think, Alex, you've joined us in this, and Steve's been kind of doing both of this for a long time, is to wake up the evangelical community, the very community.
So we just hit on it. That's what will power us.
Yeah. They have a passion, a commitment for truth, and it's interesting. The evangelicals have been behind the eight ball on this thing. So what
I was about to say, even though they've not been really criticizing the globalists as of yet, they're starting to. There's pre-demonization of them in all these government manuals. They better just start exposing it now because they're already the target.
Absolutely, and you brought out the story on the clergy response teams. Okay, I call those guys that a pastor that has joined that, I call them the Pied Pipers to Perdition, okay? They're going to lead their flocks, literally, being told what they're, that it's basically on a misunderstanding of Romans into the FEMA camps. Now, listen, ladies and gentlemen, we are in the most perilous time in history, and it's got to just slap everybody in the face that now the headlines on Matt Drudge are exclusively dealing, it's getting more and more weird, Alex. So what Gary was talking about, the fallen angels, these entities, and I said Zachariah Sitchin,
nothing makes sense until you realize the elite are into this. Whether it's real or not, they are manifesting it because humans are able to build whatever we envision, and the elite believe they're getting off-world technology and building it.
Well, they
and you can look around and see what they're building, a high-tech something.
And they're all getting ready to go underground because, you know, the word zombie, and it applies to this, a zombie is something that appears to have life, but it's dead. It has a life force beyond the normal life force. It's why Hollywood pushed so many demons.
Stay there. I want to ask you, because I mentioned this in the News Rights article saying I'm a liar. It's been in the Associated Press, you name it, that for the last 5 years they're training the Marines and Army to, quote, take out mass zombie attacks. which is a archetype of just humans in a mob mentality, act like zombies. So instead of saying, oh, we're training to mow down Americans, we train to fight zombies that don't exist. But then they do exist because, again, it's all basically a double meaning. Let's talk about that with Steve Quayle, Gary Haven, and the threat of World War III straight ahead. All right, we're going to talk about the Methuselah gene. We're going to talk about a lot of really heavy things here. And here's my point. Whether you believe in this, whether I believe in this, the elites believe in it. And they have discovered cancerous cells that never die. They're called immortal cell lines. The first one was found here in the United States back in the 40s. And the cells are still alive today. And the military is training to, quote, take out mass zombie attacks. I'm talking Associated Press. I'm talking Business Insider. This news is 4 or 5 years old. Pentagon document lays out battle plan against zombies, 2014. Now, I was talking about it 2 years before it was even in the news. Because that's, again, how they say, we're not practicing to mow down citizens. It's just zombies for fun. But what they mean is masses of citizens during collapse of society, people act like zombies. But you take it even further than that, Steve Quayle, and then Gary Haven.
Well, zombies has a twofold meaning. The zombies are those who are left on the surface of the earth after all these calamities happen. And that's the, kind of the coverall theme for anybody that's not one of the elite. But that's on the left hand. On the right hand are the zombie viruses. And Alex, I've literally interviewed a military, high-ranking military guy that went into great detail about the test zone in Iraq for the actual release of some form of a zombie virus, and talked about a guy walking, multiple witnesses, with half his head gone, a hole in his chest, dragging his arm backwards and breathing out of lungs that are gross. Now, I'm sorry to be gross, but that's exactly what he
viruses
said.
That turn off the normal synapses of the body and let it go even further.
Right.
And isn't that associated with rabies viruses?
Right. And remember, we're in the age of rabies viruses, but we're in the age of the most, it's a cornucopia of evil brewing in a.
And they're just testing everything.
And everything. And by the way, the Human Genome Project was specifically designed and funded to find the, if you will, the demon blood strains of.
I was about to say, and in the new Superman movie, again, they admit all these big famous comic book writers that it's propaganda placement or predictive programming to get people ready for things. You've got the Doomsday character that cannot be killed,
right?
Because he's this mutagenic abomination.
Mutagenic abomination. There used to be a time when comic book carriers were, comic book characters were the good guys, Superman, Truth, what, Justice, and the American Wave, and the American Way. Now you got Superman fighting Batman, and so many superheroes, but what are they saying? The future belongs to genetically altered people or entities or robots versus to us. And
now they're saying robots are going to have rights. You aren't. They're totally,
yes,
admittedly preparing us. Gary Haven.
Yeah, you know, they call this predictive programming. You know, all the kids now are worshiping these comic heroes that have had genetic alterations. And of course, Steve writes about that. You know, I want to mention something about virus. When millions of us received the polio virus as children, we were contaminated with cancer cells.
It's admitted.
Yeah, yep. And that is a fact that's SV40. Easy to find. And so trusting the medical community to care about you without questioning them, believe me, they have not proven their trustworthiness to me.
And Gary, keep going. I just want to add, it's in the mainstream news today. Kids in the West and young people are the most depressed they've ever been. Women are the most depressed. But they say, I don't care. I want my video games. I want my iPhone. I want my TV. And they actually get defensive if you warn them that they've been programmed by it. Because to them, it's the real world.
That's so true. Alex, all the video games, all of virtual reality was designed to take thinking out of the realm of the next generation or the next two generations, because that's their world. They don't understand history. You've done the math.
It's the proto-matrix.
It is. And it gets worse than that, because they're divorcing them, and they will then believe a superhero coming on their iPhone or on their iPad or whatever going, hi, I'm the superhero.
That's their new friend that they...
Yes.
Real people won't be influencing them. It'll be their... Well, they admit dating sites. Most of it's a fake bot.
Right. And it'll be basically a sympathetic demon saying, oh, I understand your problems.
They admit it's going to be an AI conscious algorithm that's a real thing, and then you bring into your house the little Amazon computer that you talk to that runs everything.
Absolutely. And remember this, any computer that runs anything is watching everything you're running, doing, thinking, feeling. And why is it the Defense Department was so concerned with all of their neural, their brain enhancement, their brain reading, the whole, if you will,
interface.
Yeah, the interface. Thank you.
The brain has no firewall.
Right. And the idea is this, is that to control everything that their soldiers think. Look, they are doing away with veterans for one reason primarily, and that is because those men and women would give their life because they love this country.
They're not perfect, but they're the last free independent warriors.
Absolutely.
They're the final phase out of humanity. They're phasing out families, women, men, everything. Plants won't produce seeds that produce seeds anymore. It's the death of this planet's system that God created. We're seeing the extermination, the execution of the planet by the very people that claim to the guardians. Gary Haven.
Yeah, you know, we got to realize scripturally, Satan's hates people because we are made in his image. And it's all about destruction. He wants to destroy everything. And these global.
And even if Satan didn't exist, which we know he does, this is Satan. This is what the Bible said. This is it.
Yep. And joining the spiritual realm to the liberty movement is critical right now. And I'm so glad.
Let's talk about that. Let's talk about fighting back.
Okay. You know,
that's what you're doing. You're taking this message directly to the.
Yeah. You know, I could be on a desert island somewhere enjoying myself. I've made all the money I need. So why am I bothering with this? Well, I'm bothering with it as if my life depended on it. My grandchildren, your family's lives depend on it. We have an enemy. You know, I love the line out of the movie H.L.L. Elkin, always have trouble with that movie. You'll recognize it. The hero tells the king, the enemy is upon us. And the king says, I'm not prepared for open warfare. And he says, well, be prepared or not, the enemy's here.
That's right.
And, you know, so we have to realize, I don't care how afraid you are, how busy you are.
People think if they just deny this, then it goes away. No, the only way to be safe is to fight it.
You know, absolutely.
Churchill said, I love what Churchill said. He says, an appeaser is someone who feeds the alligator hoping he's not going to eat him. And that's the world we live in right now. Guys, the alligator's coming for you.
Well, hoping the alligator eats you last.
Yeah.
You're just stalling.
Yeah. Go ahead, Steve.
Well, we've been thrown to the alligators. We're thrown on, their goal is to throw us on the trash heap of history. Here's the thing, everyone. Throw out the word conspiracy. You can watch it in real time on network news. Everybody has teamed up against.
They're unified. They're lying. They've got fake polls. They're delisting him on Google. They're lying about us. They're saying, shut down Breitbart. Shut down Drudge. Shut down Jones. They're openly saying, shut us up. They've said on MSNBC and Salon, I should be arrested.
Well, look, here's the deal. In a kingdom of liars, telling the truth is the ultimate enemy. And what people have got to, here's what, they don't even have to wrap their heads around it now. They can see. I don't need to tell somebody who used to be middle class and now they can't even feed their families that the country's changed. Liars, liars, liars. And there's a wonderful passage in the New Testament that men will give heed to seducing spirits. They will give heed. That means they will be taken in by lying demons. And
then they believe the con more than reality.
Yeah, and by the way, lawlessness, that's called the mystery of iniquity in the New Testament. We are a lawless society. When the director of the FBI absolutely goes into a great, basically, soliloquy on, yes, she's guilty, but basically, I can't do anything about it. That's the
bottom. That's a declaration that evil has taken over.
Evil reigns. Evil reigns. And the only thing to hold back evil, obviously, is when good men do nothing. But more than that, the definition of conspiracy, Alex, no one can accuse anybody of that word because they'd have to admit that those who they listen to, mainstream news, that those people are doing is this. They're vilifying to destroy. And that's what's at stake.
I was about to say, and Gary and Steve, Gary Haven, speak to this, though, because you started getting into it earlier. You're going out, reaching out to evangelicals. You're going out, getting on these programs that reach hundreds of millions of people potentially. And that's great because that's an audience that has been absolutely on target with so many issues, but also in the dark about the fact that it's actually happening right now.
Yeah, Steve and I were on the Jim Baker program this last week. He's got a huge audience, and what a great opportunity to really speak truth to people. You know, the evangelical community is a natural community to turn this country around. You know, we're committed to truth. We serve the author of truth, Jesus Christ. And yet, the evangelicals have been held back. And I hate to say it, but it's a lot of these nonsense going on there into their churches. You know, they hear about name it and claim it and the myth about the pre-trib rapture that we're all going to check out of here before this happens. Guys, you need to get in your Bible and learn the truth. But I've been given the privilege to speak to that audience because I'm one of them. I'm a Christian, and I understand the truth. And I'm also part of the liberty movement, and I'm part of the truth movement. And to join these two together, we can take our country back. Now, there's going to be a battle, and there is going to be a new world order. The question is, will we be a remnant that escapes from the real destruction?
And by the way, this is the most dangerous thing you've ever done. You know, Chuck Norris said, you know, to you and his son about the film, we'll get ready for him to come after you, putting this film out. Trying to go in and get the Christian churches moving in the right direction, like the Black Brigades of 1776, is the key to this. Yeah. And, you know, that's you can tell why they went after Baker and attacked him, because he's the type of guy that actually will talk about this now. And despite them trying to destroy him, you know, he's back on his feet again and reaching tens of millions. It's a testimony of how they demonize, how they lie, and what they do. But the good news is it's got to really worry the globalists. I go back to this. The military is so awake. The police are so awake. This is going to be spectacular. This collision of forces is going to be amazing.
Well, it's going to be, Jesus said it like this, there's never been a time in history like it, nor would be again. And except the days were shortened for the elect's sake, there'd be no flesh left alive. Well, Alex, when we're talking about zombies, we're talking about transhumanism, we're talking about the destruction of 90%. You and I broke the story on Deagle, and the Deagle, remember the survey? We did that on your show, and they even, Deagle put up, look, we're not a conspiracy, we're not some kind of satanic cult, we're just telling the information that we have available based on the death of the middle class, how few of Americans are going to be. And you remember what the percentage was? It was really low. In other words, we went from 330 million people, Gary,
to 60 million. And by the way, they just released some new numbers. And
let's talk about these studies they've done. Let me come back. Wow. Gary Haben and, of course, Steve Queller, our guest. Both of their new films are available at InfoWarsStore.com, Armageddon and The Unholy Sea. I want to talk some about The Unholy Sea, also get into some of the latest news, developments, Donald Trump, what we should be doing to support Donald Trump and more. Steve Quayle, 25 years on radio, written dozens of books, a staple of Coast to Coast AM, and of course our show. He's here in studio. Gary Haben has been personally flying him around. Gary pilots his own jet, or jets, to speak to groups and go on television programs to warn people because there's so much crazy stuff happening. Now, we're going to obviously have in the fourth hour a lot of the topical news and things that are happening in the world today covered. David Knight is back from a well-deserved vacation, so David Knight will be here in studio. But shifting gears into just news in general, teenagers struck by depression, the Times of London, an epidemic. And again, this modern world is not empowering people. This is being done by design. How do we reach out to young people? Obviously, young people are one of our greatest assets. They're one of the most awake groups, but it's a paradox. They're also one of the most unawake groups. It's almost like there's a division. How do you reach somebody in the matrix?
Let me start with this one. You know, John D. Rockefeller, who amassed a fortune. In today's dollars, it was over $600 billion. So he was by far the wealthiest man in the world, probably up at the level of Solomon. Well, he took his money and funded a variety of things. And one of them was the education system. And a quote from Rockefeller was that we don't want people that are thinking. We want people that are workers. And so they funded an education system that for all of these years has really taken away the ability to think clearly, to think critically from our education
system. Created robots.
Yeah. And so they've really had, they've got 100 years investing in taking away the ability for people to think as individuals. And so I think the first thing we tell our young people is, hey, step back and think. We teach them how to think critically so that they can look at the evidence that's all over them. And, you know, Alex, one of the things I'm excited about is there's so much evidence. My gosh, it's almost every day there's something in the news that there's no way to explain it except for what they want to call conspiracy. It's no longer conspiracy. It's fact. And so
sure, why would NBC News and ABC all in the last few months come out? And I was saying, why is it suddenly all over the news on CBS, NBC, ABC, 666, 666, you want to take a chip, you're going to get a chip. And I went, wait, the date 666 is coming up. Everything with these people is messages. Go ahead.
Yeah, and you know, the chip and the idea that you'd have to take this mark to buy or sell, You know, that was written 2,000 years ago. And guess what, guys? Here we have the technology. We have the computer system that can control zillions of contractions.
Exactly.
It is upon us.
Steve Quayle, what is the chip? What is the face scan? What is the mark of the beast?
Well, the mark of the beast, obviously, people will argue over it, but the mark of the beast, the word literally means to inscribe in the skin on the hand or in the forehead. Obviously, there's genetic tattoos. There's all sorts of subdural implants. But here's what
the government's got to give you something or you don't buy and sell.
Right. You don't buy, sell, or trade. And that's where we're going to be faced. The ultimate decision for Christians, are they going to yield and capitulate and lose their salvation? Because, listen, when the day comes, by the way, the nice thing about the mark of the beast is, biblically, God won't leave us without a witness. There'll be two witnesses in the book of Revelation that are saying, this guy's the bad guy, and I'm talking supernatural. They'll have the power.
But those witnesses finally get killed?
Yeah, after 3.5 years, and they lie. Their bodies lie in the streets of Jerusalem, and everybody gives gifts, okay? They're just happy they got rid of these two voice pieces for the God they've hated so long.
Yeah, these two voices of truth.
But they're protected for several years.
Yeah, they're protected up until the day they die, and they're able to smite the earth with all the plagues, counter plagues. It's kind of like the Egyptian pharaoh was able to do his dirty deeds, but then God sent his servant Moses to deliver.
And that's Newtonian physics.
Yeah, absolutely. But see, here's the thing, too. I'm looking at your headlines. Teenagers struck by depression epidemic. I would like to know two things. How many of those kids are on SSRIs, okay? How many of them are gamers? Look, I have nothing against playing video games, but if they're programming you to basically at a certain subliminal thought go out and go on a killing rampage, I'm against a Pokemon. Pokemon, ladies and gentlemen, pocket monsters, and the craze, that is the biggest neuro-linguistic
program. Well, they admit that you're recording everything for Google in live time.
Absolutely.
And it tells you where to go to get the monster, not knowing you're documenting everything for it.
They want everybody's immediate surroundings. They want everybody's immediate friends. And like I said, it all goes into an algorithm. It goes into a matrix.
Let's talk more about the technocracy when we come back. Okay. Steve Quayle and Gary Haben, stevequayle.com. Gary Haben's here. We are the exclusive distributor for another week or so that it's in stores nationwide of Amerageddon, $5 million budget film on a near future probable reality. Very important. You get a free bottle of colloidal silver when you get a second copy of Amerageddon, available at InfoWarsStore.com. That helps support the broadcast. You are the InfoWars. Stay with us. Steve Quayle is our guest exclusively here in studio. I mean, you never see this guy on TV, but he's now making films. He's now going on international TV and radio broadcasts, and he's here with us after 21 years interviewing him, and Gary Haben has brought him here. Very thankful for that. I've asked Gary to come in here basically whenever he wants to because he's a great co-host here with the broadcast. Now, I didn't take a lot of phone calls today, if I didn't take any, just because we've got so much to cover. But throughout the week, I will be taking phone calls. Donald Trump's coming to town tomorrow. We're going to have crew out there covering that live as well. But I want people to understand something. Our reality is not what mainstream media is putting out. Obviously, that's a statement that stands on its own. And I don't know all the answers on the things we've covered here today. But they are pushing the mark of the beast. They are pushing you will take vaccines, you will take a chip. Just 10 years ago, they would say it didn't exist, or we have chips, but kooks don't like them. Now it's you will take one. And so there's this belligerence that's now being put out there that is waking a lot of people up. I see the globalists losing a lot of ground, but I guess they've got to go ahead and emerge and go to their final steps because that's their plan. And then it looks like they're going to go authoritarian and try to enforce it, again, just like the Bible states.
Absolutely. You know, it's fascinating that they're going by their script. I think God made the devil this ultimatum. You must warn them before you do it. And that's what we're seeing right now. Every signal, every policy, every action, they're telling you what they're going to do. And Alex, there's so many people that deny that they're really following their blueprint. Look, obviously, we're seeing the Middle East war. We're seeing the Christians, the war on Christianity. We're seeing the total destabilization of nation states, etc. But the supernatural element is still what's affecting our kids. Just to touch bases, teenagers struck by depression epidemic. The only thing that's going to set them free is truth. They're already too much into the matrix. The only thing that's going to set them free is values. And, you know, when someone said, well, Common Core, you know what I said? There was a cartoon show, Tom Terrific. The bad guy in that show was Krabby Appleton, rotten to the core. It's the same thing as all public education.
They'll go 10 miles out of their way to hurt somebody when doing the right thing is right there in front of them.
Absolutely. So it's destruction by design. I used to say dumb unto death, okay? That's dumb unto death. Now it's dumb unto destruction. They've got to wake
up. Well, my dad used to always sit there and explain to me. He'd say, son, there are people that would rather screw you out of the nickel than make $100 with you. They just want to screw you.
Absolutely.
And I'm thinking, really? Because, you know, I was a nice guy. My dad was nice. And got into life. It's like, wow, people really don't even really want prosperity. They just want to run everything, even if it's a pile of skulls.
The global elite, besides being Luciferians, besides being some of the most horrific entities on Earth. When I use the word entity, by the way, Alex, I mean something that's not human, okay? I want to make that clear. Or someone who has submitted their humanity to total demon possession.
Why do you think Obama always has little flies landing on him?
Well, can I tell you something? Michelle Obama, and you should have your guys look this up, was talking about his odor, okay? Now, I'll tell you why. Beelzebub in the New Testament means Lord of the Flies, okay? Lord of the Flies. So Beelzebub is another name for who? Satan.
And I mean, it's amazing, though. Almost everywhere he goes, there's just flies all over the place. Well, and the media makes a joke out of that. It's true.
Well, it's just like this. There's a picture, and I can't find it. Maybe you guys can research it. But Tony Blair had, in the old days of videotape cameras, he had a reverse Polari incident. And what was on that image, Alex, was something that was a classic representation of a demon. Pointed ears.
Oh, I remember Drudge carried it.
Yeah.
And it was like on TV, and it was like ears and a demon and horns.
Yeah, and the same thing happened to Hilarious, okay? Hillary. H-E-L-L-A-R-Y.
Well, she doesn't need that to happen. She has that weird Joker demon face. I mean, if I saw somebody in a parking lot with that face, I would go away from them.
Right, but here's the thing. The idea of what I'm just saying about the image captured on Tony Blair was also captured on Hillary, and that was on Matt Drudge, too. But it was a Tony Blair one. If you can find it, to show it. What's happening now?
Yeah, guys, Google Tony Blair demon, but let's go further. Yeah. It was in major British newspapers, because back then I wouldn't cover this stuff. That was right before I went into Bohemian Grove, because people, you know, basically hired me to do it. I didn't even believe it was going to happen. I mean, even back then, like 1999, 2000, I was still having you on, but going, oh, come on, Steve. And and it was in the British papers that he would be possessed by the spirit of the light in the morning. His wife admitted this.
Right.
And that he would fall on the ground and flop around and get his orders. And it was in the newspapers. And then his wife was defending it.
Yeah, and they went to the Great Pyramid of Giza, remember, and spent the night there.
And Francois Mitterrand has the 666 pieces of glass for the pyramid at the Louvre.
Yep.
And dedicated it to Lucifer.
Absolutely.
That's in the newspaper.
Well, here's the deal. The war is now plain for all to see. And it's very clear, Alex. It's playing out.
No, that's not the one. It's him at a lectern, and it was weird. It was like he like suddenly, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Yep. Well, and okay, the image you have on the screen right there a moment ago, the all-seeing eye, what's that? That's on your dollar bill on the top. But what is the critical issue about this? Lucifer was denied publicly but worshipped individually or in secret, okay? Mm-hmm. And so now they're all open, okay? They're all open. Hollywood is overplaying their hand, and they're overplaying it because they think there will be no challenge. I've said this before. They will not write the last pages of history. God, who will act in history, is about to act. I said there's going to be something coming really quick, and I believe it's going to be, supernatural in origin that is going to rattle this country one more time. I don't know if it's a horrific earthquake. I don't know. But it's going to be something so out of their control that they're going to have to basically go on and say, well, what does this mean? And the talking heads will have no answers, and then you and I and Gary will be on saying, this is exactly what it means.
Well, all I know is there is a mocking of God, a mocking of decency, a feeling of invincibility with these people when history shows they are not invincible. So there is this hubris, there is this arrogance to them.
Well, arrogance is always basically based on someone who thinks they're in control. But I believe that what we're seeing right now is I believe we're seeing played out before the American citizenry, Hillary's programming melting down. Her body, they can only juice her so many times with whatever.
Oh, let me bring that up. Yeah. What is your intel, or you as well, Gary? I'm going to fix that earpiece because I've seen you do it.
Thank you.
And this is fun on air. We're teleprompter free. Yeah. Well, it should be popping in here. I'll just cram it in there. There you go. Okay. I'm going to fix that on air. That's a teleprompter free, folks. That's how we do it. If you're a radio listener, Infowars.com/show. Is that better? Or just cram it in there, or we'll get you a new, fresh earpiece.
Okay, this is good now. It's turning.
Fantastic. What is going on with her health? Because I know she, you know, had these brain surgeries and she was in the hospital off and on for over a year. And clearly something's going on, but she looks worse and worse every week. Is it the campaign trail? All these doctors say she looks like she has serious problems. They say it's a conspiracy theory. What do you think's going on?
Well, I think you had Steve Pachinik on, who I know personally, you know, known him for years in Bozeman.
Yeah, by the way, he says hi.
Tell him hi. Hey, Steve. The bottom line is a very bright man, probably one of the brightest men. You know it. I know it. We know it.
Super famous spot chief.
Yeah, yeah. And by the way, the second most famous man to be murdered after Andrew Breitbart, remember, was Tom Clancy. And Tom Clancy.
He co-wrote books with Clancy.
Yeah, he
wrote. By the way, Clancy was starting to go public about the New World
Order. Yes, he was. And the thing that I think was the trigger point is when he was going to bring up the collusion between our government and the control of radical Islam, okay? Now, what's interesting to me about this is that you're seeing the fullest implementation, Alex, of the complete destruction from within. Everybody who's in, you know, let's call him the Lord of the Flies, is the Lord of the Flies administration is bent on.
Ooh, that's a good name for it.
Yeah, let's use that, you know, because you asked me the question, and let me share this too. When you're in the world of evil spirits and true biblical deliverance, the evil spirits that come out always have, seriously, a smell of sulfur, and it's fascinating, or a smell of feces, let's just be blunt. So what I find is fascinating that in so many instances of Bohemian Grove, you're told what the people do, all this stuff, it's centered around that which...
Oh, I was asking earlier, in Skull and Bones, they're worshiping angels. They believe we're giving...
Fallen angels.
They believe angels, eulogia, goddesses, but they do it in big pools of feces.
Right. And, you know, without trying to be too overly overt in my statement, the thing is that isn't it interesting? That represents death. Feces never represent life, okay? It represents live food that passes through your body that comes out, okay? So what we're seeing here is a total embrace of death. These people worship death. And all of us are to be the sacrifices. Our children, okay? Our grandchildren. I mean, they want to end the human line within the next several years at the latest.
And they're doing it through the vaccines that clearly have binary systems to change our DNA.
Right. One of the other things, since I was the guy that brought out chemtrails in the first, I've always been concerned about a binary follow-up. In other words, that would be the primary spraying, but at some point they introduce some form of a virus or some form of a nanoparticle that basically...
And by the way, they have a lot of kooks out there that misrepresent things so they can then... distract everybody, but what we're saying is there's hundreds and actually thousands of patents on how to put it in the fuel. It goes out the jet engines. There are real crystals out there. You know, there are real water vapor. There's real condensation trails. We're talking about persistent ones that form these pollution clouds that have darkened the earth more than 20%, according to NASA. It's a massive geoengineering program. And then Bill and Melinda Gates come out with sponsored textbooks for kids saying we're spraying sunscreen on the earth added to jet fuel. So they admit to kids they're doing it in major textbooks, but tell us it doesn't exist.
Well, you know, again,
Steve and I were at 45,000 feet of my jet the other day, and I had the privilege of being taught the difference between contrails and chemtrails at 45,000 feet with a man who, you know, who really made it public. It's real, and you can see the difference with your in front of your eyes. And, of course, people now can look up at the sky and see the difference. You know, when you and I were growing up in the 60s, the sky didn't look like
totally clear. Today. 70s, 80s, yeah.
Yeah.
Totally clear. I mean, they admit that it's dimming the earth. So what's global dimming about?
Well, global dimming, I think it's a darkness that's coming on the planet. And there's a story on Drudge today that even the monuments in Washington, D.C. are being covered in a black slime. Did you see that?
Yes.
Okay. What's happened to the light of the world? Jesus is the light of the world. The evangelical Christians, portions of them will still admit that Jesus is the Son of God. But in order to be friends with the world, they've denied the very Lord that saved them. And I make no bones about it. We are in this the situation we're in and condition we're in because the Christians didn't speak up. And Alex, look, the independent voices of, I would say, investigative journalism have been calling them to task. I'm calling them to task. So we need to get them to the point. And that's what God is opening doors for you. God is opening doors for Gary Haven. God's opened doors for me.
Well, I know this. The globalists are malevolent. They admit they're out to get people. They admit the planetary government project that's 50 times bigger than the Manhattan Project was built to bring in a planetary government to reduce the human population by 89%. That's official UN Biological Diversity Assessment 1996. The full unedited one. I went to the UT library, got copies. It's in my film, Road to Tyranny. Actual copies where they say, we're going to reintroduce human sacrifice. We're going to reintroduce games, based on debasing humans. We're going to have forced population reduction. We're going to bring in a pagan world government. I mean, they say it all in the UN. That's what's so crazy. And then they have the Lucifer Trust that runs the prayer chapel at the UN building in New York.
Absolutely. And they also have robots that are designed to basically feast on human decomposing bodies that fuel them. Okay?
That's right. The Pentagon bought a bunch of those that just go around killing people and then eating them.
Yep. And that's not nonsense. You know, I wrote the whole book about it. And by the way, I'm telling people this, that if you want the true understanding of chemtrails, you've got, and this isn't a pitch for the book. This is a pitch for the CIA revelation in the book on page 241 through 248. And it's a remarkable thing. Not only do the chemtrails take us back to a different atmosphere, if you will, a very time of primordial evil, but it also alters all the frequencies and waves, and God keeps things in
the... I was about to say, they admit now what the old timers said thousands of years ago, that the moon, obviously the sun's the main driver of climate, but then the moon, when it gets in front of the sun or in front of the earth with the sun behind it, will block a lot of the solar rays, but not just solar, the other space rays and the other particula, the many meteorites that are coming in, I guess, by the billions every day, that forms the nuclei for rain and weather and all of it. That entire frequency system is being changed and manipulated.
Absolutely. And Gary, share about the moon rise, because that was very cool. I looked, I said, I know this is significant, but I don't have it yet. All years you've been flying, 40-plus years. Share with Alex. It's an amazing thing.
Yeah, on Thursday, we were at 45,000 feet as the evening came on, and the moon literally came out of the ground underneath us in rows. I've been flying for 40 years. I've really never noticed or seen that phenomenon. And by the way, also, that you could see the shadow of the Earth as the sun had set. And by the way, the shadow was a curvature, not a line.
Yeah, exactly. I love these crazies that say it's flat. But, you know, that shows how people mistrust the media so much that they go to the other extreme of them thinking everything's a lie.
Yeah. I tell you what, we are living in the most fascinating times.
We're living in science fiction. You've got all that. You're flying around in your private jets yourself, and, you know, we're fighting the New World Order, and there's, you know, pharmacological crops that can grow thousands of different. They can grow live vaccines in crops. You know, you got spiders that are part goat. You got doors on cows now that they grow humanoids in. And I was reading about it in a technical magazine, and I talked to somebody who'd been up at MIT, but out at one of their farms. They said, yeah, it's true. You know, I was there as part of my, MIT degree at the end of it, and they took us in and showed us the cows with the doors on the sides.
You know, Steve shared with me some fascinating
things. They've cut doors in on the sides and just go into the uterus whenever they want. Sorry, go ahead.
Steve shared some fascinating, you know, hanging out with this guy 24 hours a day is just mind-boggling. He has a friend who's actually walked in. He kind of went down that path a minute ago. But people were in, not people, chimeras were in cages. Share that, a moment of that.
I remember you talked about this over a decade ago, and I thought you were nuts. But even though it was in publications, they have these.
Absolutely. A gentleman who was stationed in Texas, a big-time intelligence operator, he openly admitted to being an assassin. He openly admitted doing all this kind of evil stuff. But I dropped him off at the airport the last time I ever saw him alive. And he said, I want you to know this. There are secret government labs all over the country under the ground. And he said, there are human-animal hybrids. And he said, the thing that even got his attention, and he said, I'm an evil man, but we're half-human-animal hybrids. And the human part of him was saying, help me, I'm a human. Alex, he broke like a dam and wept. And then I saw someone.
Well, I talked to a well-known genetic engineer, and they just told me, they said, listen, I'm not going to even get into it. Go ahead.
But here's the issue. Every wonderful thing that God made. Remember when there were blue skies? I remember I used to, as an early photographer, I called them F-16 days. That's when you had the brightness, the beautiful white clouds, yeah, and you could just get a great photo. The thing is that everything that was bright now is being just distorted, turned out. Isn't it interesting? The symbols of this country are being covered in a black slime, okay? Everything is falling apart. We are going into...
The CIA admittedly said they financed ugly art and ugly buildings.
Absolutely.
Things that will rot and look bad to make us feel bad.
Right, and it's all a psyop. You know, I told...
They want to give vaccines that, quote, stop anxiety, but actually stops the higher order thoughts.
Right. Well, after meeting with someone who we met with over at Jim Baker's very highly placed source, you know, I said to one of your guys, I said, let's have a national kill your iPhone day. I promise you, listening to him, I'm going back to flip phones, okay?
By the way, that's what Drudge has always said. And I, even though I can use iPhone to shoot video, everything, I'm just going to use a camera. I'm done. It's gone.
Yep.
In fact, it's, I mean, because they're horrible. They're sitting there typing, sending people stuff. It's crazy.
Right.
Why do we do this?
And my iPhone was taken over the other day. My camera turned on. And
I didn't even know. I was telling you that happened to us.
Yeah, it just happened to me 2 days ago. My computers turn on when I shut them down.
That's happening to Roger Stone.
Yep.
I mean, they've announced they're just using their cyber system now to do whatever they want. They're just getting us used to it, saying, hey, we're not going to let you see any news about Hillary being sick. For a couple of years, I put out a magazine basically at cost, and it was successful. But compared to shooting one video and it reaches a million people, it just wasn't feasible to spend all my time messing with it. But one of the first magazines we came out with was a design that I came up with that I think really says it all. And it's this all-seeing eye pyramid that is jacked into the dehumanized devil's creation of a copy of what God had made, built on a pile of human skulls. This is an emergency transmission. And then we break down the end of humanity, rise of the robots. And they just tell us everywhere. All these socialist governments say the answer to you not having a job is robots, which they admit will make you even more obsolete. I mean, this is so obvious. Steve Quayle, and of course, Gary Haben, other comments you want to impart to the listeners and viewers?
Well, we're seeing a technologically decadent society. I coined a term when I went on talk radio, technecadence, okay? Technological decadence. We're seeing the fulfillment, whether people believe it or not, we're seeing the fulfillment of the words of Jesus, that they literally, the Illuminists, the elite, the globalists, want the destruction of human flesh. And not only that, they're going to power the robots with human flesh. And you know what, Alex? Well, you talked about the Mark of the Beast. I got to get something. You know what the very first name of the very first chip that was able to basically do all of the things that were going to be in the future? It was 20 years ago. It was called the Soul Catcher chip.
I remember.
Yep. And you and I think that was one of our first or second shows we did together 21 years ago. But what would possess, good word.
Yeah, we go to wide shots. People can see this.
Yep. What would possess them to name that the Soul Catcher? Again, it's a dehumanization. This is what's at stake, ladies and gentlemen. It's not your retirement. It's not, you know, gee, where do you go on vacation next month? It's what do I do to do as be as most the most informed I can become and be as active as I can become.
And by the way, they're creating an economy where you almost have to be in their system. They plan to force everybody into it to even communicate and warn people. You've got to be, you know, part of the system, but not of it, I guess. I want to play this clip since you mentioned it. We're going to come back and talk to Gary Haben and then hand the mic over to David Knight. Now, this is from, I think, NBC News, CBS News, ABC News. We've got them all saying your children will get microchips soon. Here it is.
You know, chances are if you have a four-legged family member at home, it's already microchipped. And if the technology exists to save Fido in an emergency, what about microchipping your child? Before you say, no way, I would never do that, hear one mom's story.
It's the longest 2 seconds of your life, and it's absolute panic.
I want my son back.
We've seen it in movies.
This is my son.
Let's stop right there. So your child's going to be safe if they just get this chip. We're not going to get into how that's all bull. And at the end of the report, they say, so soon, your child will get a chip.
Yeah, you know, they package all of this as to our benefit. And by the way, my definition of this Mark of the Beast is simply a barcode. It's pretty much the same barcode that a banana at Walmart has. And that's how they see us.
You make yourself a commodity, a human resource.
Exactly.
They even tell you you're a human resource.
Yeah. And if people research the barcode, it begins with a six. There's a six in the center to tell the reader to switch to a different set of information, and it ends on a six. Did you know that?
I did. It's crazy. In fact, here is the end of the clip. Let's play that.
And guys, this is what we're talking about, the microchip. I don't know if you can see it in my hand. It's the size of a grain of rice, very, very small. And the expert that we spoke with actually tells us that barcodes were introduced in the late 1960s. And back then, people thought, this is way too invasive and too weird. And now barcodes are so commonplace that we don't even think about them anymore. The expert tells us this will happen sooner rather than later.
Again, a nice pretty blonde out there. Keep your kids safe. Take the chip. It's like Eve. Just, you're going to live forever. Just take this, baby.
Yeah. Well, I won't do any blonde jokes on that, but what I will say is this, is that soft selling death is never, ever, ever received by the people that are buying the lie.
Okay? We should make some ads to counter that, that show an authoritarian future. We got to have it to buy and sell and what that's like. And what would Hitler have done with this?
Exactly. And Alex, we're at the point now where people better recognize It's no longer a conspiracy theory.
World government is here. Stay there. And the film, The Unholy Sea, available now on InfoWarsStore.com and exclusively Amerigeddon. And you can get colloidal silver free when you order the Amerigeddon second copy. Stay with us. Well, David Knight is going to be breaking down, I would imagine, a lot of the current news that's breaking and information that's coming out. We've got Gary Haben here, a producer, and he also stars in the very powerful film Amerigeddon, available at InfoWarsStore.com. I want to thank you for your purchase of that. It funds our operation. You get a second copy, get a bottle of Silver Bullet Colloidal Silver. We now are covering The Unholy Sea, of course, with the main host of it being Steve Quayle at InfoWarsStore.com. Let's spend a few minutes on The Unholy Sea. I mean, I've never been a Catholic basher. A lot of great Catholic people. You know, you can have corrupt people as Protestants, whatever, on both sides. But I tell you, now the Pope, I mean, sounds like the devil. I mean, it's incredible. I mean, he's given Obama a major run for his money, calling for world government, saying Europe shouldn't be Christian. I want to get a comment from you on that, and then Gary Haben.
Well, first of all, The Unholy Sea, Alex, was set up to basically show that there's been a tight control over real history and that all roads lead to Rome. When our film crew, Tim Alberino, by the way, did a great job on the writing and the producing of the, I'm the producer, he directed it. But the point being is that The Unholy Sea, the movie shows the very control of ancient history, which, by the way, is underground tunnel systems, the giants, the cover-up of the history of the giants. And see, the giants are coming back, and that's what's critical, because this is what DARPA's doing. And in The Unholy Sea, we actually have the pilot interview of the gentleman that flew the dead giant back from Afghanistan in 2005. He goes into Bagram Air Force Base, or Bagram, I guess some of them pronounce it.
So a lot of really, really wild stuff in the film.
It's wild, but it's also documented. Tom Horn's on record.
Here you got the pilot.
Yeah,
crazy.
Yep, Tom Horn is in this, talking about when he went to the Vatican Observatory on Mount Graham in Arizona, the leading graduate observatory specialist in the Catholic Church in the world, were openly talking about they had to wait for the unidentified flying objects to clear the field. Now, here's the deal. Whether you believe in this stuff or not, the Catholic Church did Childhood End, you know, the movie that was on the Sci-Fi Channel based on Arthur Clarke. That entity that comes back, the Vatican is saying Jesus Christ is out, but the gods that created us are coming back, and they're the ones that created us from the primordial goo. They're coming back as an intergalactic savior. It's kind of like the Twilight Zone to serve mankind.
And of course, Arthur C. Clarke was in OSS, inventor of the telecommunications satellite.
2001. I mean,
MI6.
Yeah, guy's brilliant. So what was interesting and is fascinating is we document in The Unholy Sea the underground tunnel system in Peru that went all through the Americas called the Shinkana. And then the Coricancha, which is one of the biggest Catholic church monasteries, if you will, cathedrals in Cusco, Peru, and we get the most famous Peruvian explorer in the world, and he's allowed access at one point and denied it, you know, later on, 8 years later, and he talks about we talk about the megalithic structures. Some of these stones can't be moved today. It's one thing to move them above ground. I mean, you know, you're talking 1,000 pounds.
But up a mountain.
Yeah, but up a mountain or under the ground, and they're perfectly, basically, they come into such perfect cohesion and perfect support of each other that there's no way it can humanly be possible. I think, okay, I've got people's attention, I hope, that if you understand history, ancient history, you'll understand the future.
Well, it's certainly an intriguing film, powerful and available at InfoWarsStore.com. And again, it gets people thinking. And Steve Quayle, you've done it again real fast. Gary Haben, thanks for coming in again. Thanks for bringing this guy.
Yeah, Alex, we're really proud to be here and honored. This product that Steve's created, The Unholy Sea, I've watched it. I endorse it. It's great. And, of course, our movie, Amerigeddon, which you star in, is available now on InfoWars. And we encourage people to buy it and to share it. You know, this movie is important. It's not just a movie. It's a message. It's not just a message. It's a movement. We can take our country back. Alex, thanks to patriots like you. We're giving people hope.
Well, thank you. It's gotten great reviews. No reviews yet on InfoWarsStore.com because it just started shipping out as we speak, exclusively available. And I guess it's next week it finally hits stores?
Well, actually, Walmart's October 4th, but we are offering it through your program and soon through Steve Quayle's. So it's going to be out there and available. Please take advantage. Support these organizations that are fighting the battle for you by purchasing this movie.
Absolutely. Well, we're having a big effect. Thanks to everybody. David Knight is coming up with all the latest news and breaking information and a lot of video clips we didn't get to. Stay with us. We'll be back. I wanted to come back and hand the baton to David Knight because I haven't even seen him yet today since he got back from a week of well-deserved vacation with his wife and a great family. And, you know, over the years, I would get Steve Quayle on about his New World Order news, military news, stuff like that, because, I mean, the guy's really spot on, has a lot of really interesting sources. But I would not let him get into all of the genetic engineering stuff and fallen angel stuff, just because, you know, I can get people to even admit the Federal Reserve is private. But now, because the media is so mainstream about we're crossing humans and animals and we're creating new species and humans are bad and we're going to create a new super species, that is what Google says. That's what Ray Kurzweil says. That's what the mainline culture by billionaires and these conferences they have, that's what's being pushed. And so as wild as what Quayle's saying, it's not even as wild as what they admit they're doing. It's like if you say, I think there's fallen, you know, entities on this planet that are manipulating us, just like the Bible says, that's weird and kooky. But if the New York Times has an article saying we believe we were seeded here by aliens and we're going to ascend and merge with machines and be gods, oh, that's totally normal then. So I think it's important, regardless, to look at the mindset of the people controlling this planet and to understand that almost all of these globalist organizations believe they're going to transcend and become gods. They believe they're going to merge with machines, and they believe we have to be gotten rid of first before they do that. And that's why over the years, I've come more and more towards the way of thinking of somebody like Steve Quayle, going from his biblical perspective, but with a modern lens, because the establishment really is anti-human. And here's what I'm saying. If the devil isn't physically real, genetics in humans, in a minority of humans, whatever, of every race, color, creed, are psychopaths. That's alien to my way of thinking. And they are manifesting a will to build something quite hellish. And I don't know how people thousands of years ago, like John the Revelator on the Isle of Patmos, could envision things that are now happening. Or you could say it's a self-fulfilling prophecy and it's some missionariat protectorate, to quote Frank Herbert, to implant us with this idea. Okay, who did that? Because this is really a wild time to be alive. All I know is we're seeing world government being set up. We're seeing an attack on human biology. We're seeing sterilization of the West. We're seeing cancer in the vaccines, viruses, cells. We're seeing insane stuff go on. So the stuff they admit is so fantastical. Imagine what we don't know. Now, I know David Knight's got a lot coming up today, so I'm going to go ahead and hand the baton to him. But just on the censorship front, David Knight, the New York Times comes out and says censor news on the web of Hillary being sick, even though it's medical doctors saying it. We've got open calls for control and censorship. We've got someone trying to scale the walls and break into where Julian Assange is at. We've just got so much happening. It's like living in the Twilight Zone. What do you say to that, David Knight?
Yeah, Alex, you know, as I've been on vacation, I've been looking at the reports coming out. And as we see the focus on Hillary's health, I would like to see more focus on the cover-up of the cancer of corruption that is Hillary Clinton. I mean, we just ought to stop calling her Clinton and call her corruption, Hillary corruption. They're covering up the George Soros emails. I've got some articles here talking about how not a single mention of it by the biggest outlets of mainstream press over this last week, and they still haven't even talked about the connections with George Soros, while this weekend she is jetting in these short distances of 20 miles or whatever, all these secret meetings, all these little Bilderberg-like meetings that she's having with the large movers and shakers. Amazing contrast to what we see her doing, getting millions of dollars. She's gotten like $123 million from hedge fund managers, owners, and staff.
You know, that's a great point. I'm going to punch out and let you take over, David. It's great to see you back in studio. But that was like 2+ weeks ago, these emails of his entire system, how they're running the Islamic invasion, mm-hmm. how they want to persecute people that talk about it, how they're running the Democratic Party, how they want to censor things. Then Democrats put out fundraisers openly saying Breitbart doesn't have a right to exist. We're going to shut it down when she's elected. That is such a huge scandal, but it's beyond that. They hide it in plain view. They are authoritarian. They wear it openly on their sleeve. David Knight.
Yeah, it's absolutely amazing, Alex. We're looking at some of the things that are coming out, and of course, there's an article from Daily Caller talking about $6 billion in contracts It's either fraud or incompetence, okay? I would vote for fraud, okay? That's always the choice that we have with Hillary Clinton. Is it fraud or is it incompetence? It's like, why is somebody like that where you got to choose between being massively incompetent or a crook? Why is she running for president? Why is anybody taking her seriously? I mean, what we have here, here's the article from Daily Caller. Democrat presidential nominee Hillary Clinton may soon have to answer questions about an estimated $6 billion in contract mismanagement. It's fraud or incompetence, or maybe both. This is a nonprofit government watchdog. It's called Cause of Action Institute. They filed a Freedom of Information request on Friday to get information about this. And here's the question, folks. I mean, are we going to see the State Department suddenly hit with a plane flying into it so that all of these records pertaining to this fraud just burn up and disappear like we did?
Or what about the $6.5 trillion missing from the Pentagon?
Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm alluding to, the 9/11. You know, you got this massive investigation, all this stuff missing. And, Alex, this is only a few documents that they found. This is the tip of the iceberg, $6 billion.
And that shows that anything can come out. Assange says something he has will make her be indicted for sure. Maybe not. Maybe it could come out that she cuts little kids' throats and it, you know, hypothetically, and it just wouldn't be published because our media is so controlled. Great job, David Knight.
Absolutely. You know, we're looking at this, Alex. It's like the State Department, they say they lost contract files. They maintained incomplete contract files. And they exposed taxpayers to substantial financial losses. Well, that's only part of the story. Who made the substantial financial gains? Okay, that's what we want to know. But look at the way they do this. Here's some of the examples cited by the Inspector General of the State Department, because they now have an inspector general, which they didn't really have if you go back and look at it under Hillary Clinton. She made sure it was a temporary position that she kept changing. They reported to her they didn't really have an inspector general until Hillary Clinton left. They talk about this. Modifications and task orders were awarded to a company owned by the spouse of the State Department official managing a $52 million contract. The contract's file was missing documentation reflecting those modifications and task orders. An investigation by the inspector general turned up. Here's another one. Bid rigging, okay? A State Department contracting officer on a contract valued at $100 million falsified technical review information and provided the contractor with advanced pricing information. Okay? That is called bid rigging. They put these things up supposedly for bid. You're not supposed to know what the other people bid. They're supposed to keep it quiet and secret. But they do insider training. They tell the other people, hey, this is what the other people have bid on this contract. If you come in just a little bit below that, you'll get that. Okay, so they don't have any documentation on this. This is billions of dollars. And this is only two contract-related audits, three investigations. This is simply the tip of the iceberg. And as we're looking at this, over this weekend, and this is from the AP, they say as Clinton goes around the Northeast asking for cash, this small little area of the East Coast, you know, on Nantucket and that area, Martha's Vineyard, all this place where all of the wealthy of Wall Street are, okay, she's going to multiple closed venues. You got Donald Trump addressing thousands of people. What does Hillary do? Well, she talks over the weekend to about 2,200 campaign donors at a series of meetings. Okay, she brunches with wealthy backers in Nantucket. Then a few hours later, she has an intimate party of 30 people in Martha's Vineyard. Then on Sunday, she has an LGBT summer celebration with singer Cher. Now, with all of these different meetings, and of course, she takes a private jet just to go 20 miles because, you know, she's Hillary. She's so important. And she's got so little time to meet with all these people, okay? This is the antithesis of transparency. Now, you know, Obama told us that he was going to be transparent, right? And they talk about this with the AP. They say, well, in the 2008 campaign, Obama would allow reporters to travel with him to these elite fundraisers, but then he would shuffle them out of the room before anything important started being discussed, okay? So they said, well, we were really grateful for that little bit of glimpse into this. You know, I guess they were happy because they could at least see who was at the meeting, maybe. I'm sure some other people would come in after they got ushered out. But this is opacity. This is corruption. This is why she has her private emails, okay? This is why she has her private fundraising parties, her private speeches, where she gets paid the big bucks by the big banks, okay, in Wall Street. And they point out in this AP article, even some Democrats privately acknowledge Clinton's penchant for secrecy is a liability, given voters' continued doubts about her honesty. That is putting it mildly, don't you think? So that voters think she's dishonest because she's having all these secret meetings, because she's got this secret server, because she's doing all these things. They say, while Clinton will occasionally take questions from reporters at campaign stops, she has not held a full-fledged news conference now for more than 260 days. Remember, we started talking about this when it was 200 days. That was 2 months ago. She's not going to hold a press conference. She's not going to be open to questions. How does she handle questions? How does she get information out to people? She's got a podcast now. So she runs her own podcast. Her own people ask her specially prepared questions, and then she records it. It's not even live. It's a podcast. And then she sends it out in case, I guess, she has some kind of a brain short circuit. She's fine. Now, who are some of these people that she talked to? The American Mirror points out that some of the people she went to pick their piggy bank with were the Rothschilds, okay? Evelyn Rothschild, his good-looking blonde ladyship wife, Len Forrester. They said at that event, it was $100,000 per seat to come in and talk to Hillary. I'm sure they're just talking about nothing important, right? There's no quid pro quo. And at the same time, when we come back, we're going to tell you what Donald Trump has been getting. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host. I've been on vacation last week. One of the things I saw that caught my attention when I was gone was this call from the German government saying that for the first time since the end of the Cold War, the government in Germany is telling its citizens that they need to stockpile food and water in the event of a catastrophe. That's interesting, isn't it? That's why we tell you to prepare, to stock up for things that you're going to need. If you want to know one of the scenarios that might easily happen, of course, in Germany, they're looking at the massive influx of Muslims coming into the country. But one of the scenarios that could easily happen is one of the scenarios that plays out in Armageddon, the film that we're offering now exclusively at InfoWarsStar.com. Again, it's the film by Chuck Norris's son, Mike Norris, and Gary Haven. You can get that now exclusively at InfoWarsStore.com. When you buy two copies of Armageddon, we're giving you a free bottle of silver bullet colloidal silver. You need to start looking at the things that you need to stockpile on your own. This is it's an amazing that they would be that honest with the people, because she's still lying to them about the migrant situation. But they're telling their citizens for the first time since the Cold War to start stockpiling things to prepare for any kind of a catastrophe that could happen. Now, you can start doing that now. We offer all kinds of preparedness products at InfoWarsStore.com. But this is a great time to take a look at this. Look at the scenario that's in Armageddon. This is about an EMP that would take out the grid. And, of course, there's a lot of ways that you could lose the grid, that you could break the fragile supply chains that we depend on. As society gets more and more interconnected, more and more complex, those supply chains that are very complex are very easily broken. And we've had James Wesley Rawls on to talk about that as well. As it becomes more complex, any kind of disruption can take it down. So this is what the movie essentially plays out. You can see how that looks out. But start to think about how you can prepare for yourself. This is a special we have going on right now. Two copies of Armageddon at InfoWarsStore.com. We're the only ones carrying it right now. And at the same time, you can get a free bottle of colloidal silver. That's a $20 value for free. In addition, we have Living Defense now, 20% off until we sell out. And that's going to be soon. We're going to have to pull that pretty soon, because we do hold stuff in reserve for people who have signed up for auto ship. And again, you sign up for auto ship, you're guaranteed shipment of the supplies, as well as getting it 10% off the retail price. But we have a 20% discount right now on Living Defense. Take a look at the reviews at InfoWarsLife.com. See if that's something that would be helpful for you. You can see what other people have said about how they use it to eliminate toxic and harmful organisms from their body naturally and without harmful chemicals. Try it out. 20% off now at InfoWarsLife.com. Before we went to break, I was talking about Hillary Clinton spending the weekend going back and forth Wall Street people, the extremely wealthy in the Northeast, you know, we've had $123 million given to Hillary Clinton from hedge fund owners and employees. She got $7 million from George Soros. That's according to the Wall Street Journal back on July 29th. So that information is about 2 weeks old. That doesn't include her haul this weekend when she was jetting around, taking the 20 miles, and she takes a private jet. I mean, this is the kind of entitlement, of elitism, of privilege that ought to make the left puke. Why is it that these people are supporting somebody who is obviously the tool of Wall Street? Someone who believes that she is so entitled, and she is entitled, and she is privileged. She can break national security laws, commit multiple felonies, and just do it in the open and walk. This is Hillary Clinton. Why is the left giving her a pass on this? Just absolutely amazing to me that we see this. Now, in contrast, understand that Trump has gotten about 60% of his donations in the last cycle from people that were contributing $200 or less, okay? He's got a staff that is one-tenth the size of Hillary Clinton's. She's got about 700 people working for her and her entourage. He's got about 70 people. But here's one stat that was tweeted out by his son. He got $51 million from 400,000 donors under $200 each. Okay, the average donation was $55. 400,000 donations averaging $55 a donation. And those 400,000 were all under $200. That is a grassroots movement. That's one of the reasons why so many Republicans don't believe that if Hillary Clinton wins, it's going to be a fair election. That's why we believe it's going to be rigged. It's very easily rigged, and we've shown that many different ways. Even CBS has shown that. You've had mainstream media show that occasionally. They'll show how easy it is to rig these electronic voting machines. But when you look at the massive grassroots movement, and you look at these people, 51 million from 400,000 people, yet one guy, George Soros alone, gives her $7 million just from one of his organizations, okay? We're going to talk about what that gets him when we come back. And we're going to talk about the way he spends his money to create revolution in this country. We'll be right back. We were talking about George Soros because the mainstream media won't talk about him. And before we get back to George Soros and what he's doing with his Open Society Foundation and this massive leak that the mainstream media won't talk about, I want to play a clip for you from Hillary Clinton's campaign manager. Now, he walks back this idea that there really isn't any quid pro quo. In other words, they're really not handing out favors to these people that are giving them millions of dollars. As I just pointed out, you got Donald Trump getting an average donation of $55 from 400,000 donors, getting $41 million. And yet you've got a few people, very small number of people, like these private parties that Hillary Clinton did over the weekend, where she's getting $123 million from hedge fund managers, $7 million from just one of George Soros's organizations. Here's campaign manager, as he's talking about the quid pro quo.
A new batch of State Department emails were released last week showing Doug Band, a counselor to the Clinton Foundation, asking Clinton advisors Huma Abedin and Cheryl Mills, who were both State Department employees at the time, for a, quote, favor. And he forwarded an email from a Clinton Foundation donor and told them it was important to take care of the request. And Huma wrote back, and here's what she said. We've all had him on our radar. Personnel has been sending him options. Is this the kind of back scratching that has Americans just turned off and done with people who have been in Washington a long time?
Well, first of all, Dana, the email in question from Doug Band was coming from his private email account. It had or his Clinton.com email account. It was not related to the foundation. And the foundation at every step, or rather, the State Department at every step was following all the appropriate protocols. This was someone who had a relationship with the Clintons long before Hillary became Secretary of State.
But Robbie, the issue is not so much where the email is coming from, it's the request in general and who the request is going to, right?
Well, again, this is someone who had a longstanding relationship with the Clintons.
Yeah, money launder.
Wanted to provide some insight into a matter. And obviously the Clintons have staff that facilitate those sorts of communication, but there was no quid pro quo or anything like that here. And as I said,
the email
was originated from President Clinton's private office.
Yeah, right. Okay. So, I mean, this guy that they're talking about here is someone who had been found guilty of money laundering in Switzerland. He had bought his way out of that with a plea bargain and a $60 million fine. And then they talk to Huma and they say, yeah, we need to get him in touch with somebody in Lebanon. Yeah, we can get him in touch with these people. And he goes, do it now. Make it happen now. Okay, yeah, we're doing it. I mean, there is no reasonable person can look at this back and forth of the emails and not say that this isn't trading money for influence on the part of these people. Another one, got to get this guy a job in the State Department and so on. Okay, but you wouldn't know that there had been a leak of George Soros's information if you were looking at mainstream media. This is what Daily Caller is pointing out. They said that on June 4th, 2016, they point out the hypocrisy of the New York Times editorial. They talked about big money rearranges its election bets. So they talk about big money. They complain about it just like the Democrats complain about Wall Street. They complain about the influence on politics. And yet they back the candidate that all the Wall Street backers are getting behind. This is what the New York Times said back on June 4th, before we got this release of George Soros's information. They said both parties. Not really, okay? Both parties, not Donald Trump, okay? Yeah, the Republican establishment, absolutely. They play that same game. And that's what's different about Trump, okay? He's getting his money from the small donors like Ron Paul did. It's a true grassroots movement, okay? That's why when you look at this, we have to be very careful. The only way they're going to win this thing, if you look at these rallies, Hillary Clinton goes around and talks to 2,200 millionaires, okay, up in the Northeast, Martha's Vineyard and so forth, at $100,000 a plate dinner being thrown by the Rothschilds, while Soros is throwing $7 million at a whack at her. And then on the other hand, we've got 400,000 people giving small donations to Donald Trump. Look at the number of people that show up at their rallies. Look at the public rallies that Donald Trump has. Look at the fact that he shows up. And, of course, he's going to be here in Austin tomorrow. We're going to be covering that on the nightly news. We'll have reporters there live at that rally. Thousands of people show up at his rallies, and she can't even fill high school gyms. This is why we don't believe the polls that the mainstream media is feeding us. But listen to what the New York Times said. They were talking about the power of barely regulated super PACs. And, of course, all the liberals want to talk about is the fact that we have to control speech and money and politics, and yet they back Hillary Clinton. Okay? I do believe that money is speech. I don't believe I should have chains put on me as to somebody that I wanted to give money to if I wanted to. I don't want to give money to politicians, quite frankly. I've been there, I've done that, and I wish I had the money back. But if you want to give money to politicians, and if you want to engage in free speech, you ought to be allowed to do that, because we know that the big guys are going to have their secret meetings with the Hillary Clintons, with the George Bushes, with the Jeb Bushes, and they're going to get what they want regardless. And we don't want speech controlled by the federal government. And yet the same people who want to have the government control all elections even more tightly, even more closely, just look the other way when it's their candidate that's getting all the Wall Street money. Okay, the editors of the New York Times say, at the same time, campaigns are concealing the names of rich donors and dark money operations that are palmed off as tax-exempt social welfare agencies supposedly dedicated to doing good, not to bare-knuckle politics. Who would they be talking about? Nobody fits that description better than George Soros when he talks about, oh, we've got social welfare agencies that are doing good. We're going to tell you what he does with that money, okay? We've told you in the past, we're going to tell you again. What we do is we have documents that come out. We tell you. People don't believe it. We keep telling you that. Then more documents come out. We tell you again, and more people don't want to believe it. And we've got some more documents now about George Soros and Black Lives Matter. But the point the Daily Caller is making here is they say 2.5 months later now, when we've got internal workings of a powerful political network that has pawned itself off as tax-exempt social welfare agency, George Soros's network, okay, we've got this hack. that has been dumped in our laps. You want to talk about transparency? The only place you're going to get transparency is not from Obama, not from Hillary Clinton. You're getting it from WikiLeaks. You're getting it from DC leaks. You're getting it from people who are exposing these criminals. And yet people won't look at the information. They won't read it. Okay, so what's going on? They say, even as the Times ignored the major role of Soros' Open Society Foundation's network, okay, the paper wrote stories focusing on the role of wealthy donors in the Republican Party. See, that's the way they do it. They complain about money in politics, but you're supposed to believe that that only comes to the Republicans. Yes, it does go to the Republicans, and it should be exposed, but they ignore it when it comes from Soros. They ignore it when the money flows to Hillary Clinton. And this is what Investors Business Daily pointed out. They wrote an editorial, and they said, the Times, CNN, CBS News, the Washington Post have remained silent on the subject entirely, the subject of Soros buying these politicians. We couldn't find a single story in the New York Times, CNN, Washington Post, CBS News, or other major news sites that even noted the existence of these leaked documents, let alone reporting on what's in them. And they point out that, and this is a story that came out today, by Sunday night, last night, those news sites still had not acknowledged the existence of the leaked Soros documents. Now, New American looks at this, and they have pointed out one in particular that shows the funding of Black Lives Matter. They say when George Soros' Open Society Foundation was accused last year of funding Black Lives Matter, and, of course, we pointed that out as well, and we were pushed back. Oh, no. We're not giving money to DeRay. We're not funding Black Lives Matter. We had people we could caught with the money that they were getting from Black Lives Matter. They said, no, it didn't happen. It's a conspiracy theory. It was a fantastic rumor. They say, well, this is Ken Zimmerman. He's the director of U.S. programs at the Open Society Foundation. He flatly denied it, as they point out. He said it was simply a rumor. It was simply a conspiracy theory. He said, I can't really speculate on what leads to rumors, but it's wrong. I don't even know where one begins to reconstruct something like that. Well, we do. We know. You reconstruct it when you get the documents, okay? Again, we now have the documents. And so we found out now with these documents that have been leaked by DCLeaks.com that the Open Society Foundation board approved $650,000 to BLM. And why did they do it? Okay, they got a 69-page report from Open Society, and that's George Soros's organization. It documents its plans to use, quote-unquote, unrest following the death of Freddie Gray to, quote, accelerate the dismantling of structural inequality generated and maintained by local law enforcement. Okay, now, understand, they're trying to foment unrest. They're trying to destroy the foundations. And what they're doing is they're using fringe groups to do it. One of the other documents that's not in this report, one of the documents that I looked at was talking about how they were going to use the LGBT groups in Italy to push against Italian nationalism and towards the European Union. They said, we're going to illustrate the fact that Italy does not support LGBT issues, but the EU does. And so we want to get the LGBT crowd to focus on Italy being subsumed into the European Union. That's the way they're working this. If you go back and you look in the 1960s, you can see how Bill Ayers and others were talking about how in America, they couldn't use the same kind of class divisions that had worked for them for the communist organizers in Europe. Because we had a relatively classless society. You had class mobility. You could be poor, and you always had the opportunity of getting rich in America, far more so than anywhere else. And the perception in America was that you could move from one level to the other. So what they did was they said, we're not going to come at it from a class angle. We're going to come at it from a race level. We're going to say that you can't move in American society if you've got whites, if you don't have white skin. Okay, we're going to talk about white skin privilege. We're going to make it a racial dialogue. Okay, and that's the way we're going to divide the American public into classes. We're going to create racial classes. That's why, if you're wondering, that's why Obama's mentor Bill Ayers and others, they have taken this. That's why we have more division, more racism in America than we've had since we got Obama in. It's not because he's black, but it's because he's using racialism to push this through. Now, the U.S. Programs Board approved the $650,000 fund to invest into Black Lives Matter. And as they rightly point out in this article from New American, they say BLM, Black Lives Matter, could have used that $650,000 to actually improve the lives of black residents of America's inner city by initiating job training or educational and violence prevention programs. But instead, they used it to foment unrest. They used it to create violent protest. They used it to do things that were nothing more than violent riots. That's what we see. And quite frankly, folks, when we look at Hillary Clinton and the fact that I can't believe that the mainstream media is telling us over and over again that Hillary Clinton really doesn't want to take the guns. I mean, do you believe that for a second? I mean, that has been one of the foundations of her campaign. And I think it's interesting over this last weekend to look at what happened in Chicago. You know, we're constantly seeing these reports of terrorism, whether it's in France, Muslim terrorists in France attacking people, or we see these suicide bombs at weddings in Turkey and other places. But look at this. In Chicago, over the weekend, okay, you had 35 people wounded in shootings and 4 people killed. That's in Chicago. Chicago, where they have enacted every kind of gun control that Hillary Clinton and the Democrats want enacted. And this is a regular occurrence every weekend in Chicago. Every weekend in Chicago, we see this. Yet another bloody weekend in Chicago. It's nothing new. It's hardly even newsworthy. Okay, it's how frequently it happens. As they point out in this article from Daily Mail, in one 14-hour span, beginning on Saturday afternoon, 25 people were shot in an area that has the strictest gun control you can find anywhere. Except that California, of course, wants more. The Democrats always want more. Now they're calling, as New American points out, in California, they want to restrict guns to elderly people because, you know, they're a risk. You know, quite frankly, it is the elderly, it is women who need firearms the most for their own protection. But that's who they're coming after. On the other hand, look at what's going on in Germany. We saw this report earlier. I pointed out the fact that they're talking about how, as a leaked report from a German newspaper, talking about how they want to encourage the German people to start prepping. Now we've got the leader of the Populist Party, which is like the Donald Trump Party in Germany. Alternative for Germany is now backing the right of German citizens to keep and bear arms to protect themselves. Why? Because that is a fundamental human right. And people in Germany need to wake up out of their slumber. And they're starting to wake up because of the Muslim terrorist events. They're starting to wake up and understand that they don't have some kind of a special entitlement to a safe country, that they don't have to do anything to keep themselves safe. Like Americans, they've been put to sleep because they've had a very easy, soft existence. They've been taken care of. Even their defense budget has been taken care of by the United States. They think that their German government is there to protect them. At the same time, you've got Angela Merkel bringing in immigrants and saying terrorism didn't come from the immigrants and Islam belongs in Germany. Exactly. Okay. When we look at gun control and you look at where this is headed, look at Venezuela. Crushing 2,000 guns in public, they're planning now a registry of bullets. Similar thing to what we have here in America. They have understood now, Obama, beginning with the Obama administration, the gun control liberals have wised up. They understand that the key is ammunition. If you can control ammunition, you can turn people's guns into clubs, even if you don't confiscate them. Now, they did try to confiscate guns in Venezuela, and we reported on this. We reported back in November of 2015, this last November. We talked about the fact that we had police being hunted down on the streets and killed for their firearms because Venezuela with all the poverty that has been inflicted on them by socialism, had spent $53 million to set up gun confiscation centers. Now they are crushing guns in public, 2,000 guns crushed and drilled. And this is what they say: we're going to bring disarmament and peace. Nothing of the sort. Now they're going to go through the process, expensive process of labeling the ammunition. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. In this last segment, I want to go over a story that really, really made me angry when I saw this on Friday. A sailor who was denied a Clinton deal. And I want to give you the details of this story. It is absolutely amazing. The double standard, the entitlement, the privilege. You want to talk about white privilege? Talk about Clinton privilege, okay? That's the real privilege in this country. We're going to talk about that in just a moment. Before we do, I want to remind you that we have the new Amerageddon film pack, which is two Amerageddon movies. This is the movie that was done by Mike Norris, Chuck Norris's son, and Gary Haven, who you heard in the last couple of hours of the show with Alex Jones. When you buy two copies of this movie, and it's available exclusively right now at InfoWarsStore.com, you also get a free bottle of Silver Bullet Colloidal Silver. That's a $20 value. It really helps to support our operation. It's a 360 win. It goes through, this movie is very interesting. It goes through the scenario of a EMP pulse that takes down the electrical grid. And it's something that you ought to think about. It's something that is a conversation starter. And that's just one way that society can go down the drain. But that is a very important way. And of course, nothing is being done about that. It could very easily be addressed, but they're not interested in doing anything about that because they want chaos. So again, if you want to see that movie, if you want to pass that around, the Amerageddon two-pack, and you also get a free bottle of Silver Bullet Colloidal Silver when you get two copies of Amerageddon. Also, Living Defense, 20% off before it sells out, and it will be selling out soon. You can find that at InfoWarsLife.com. Now, quickly, before we run out of time, last Friday, we had a former Navy machinist who was on a submarine. He admitted taking photos inside a submarine. He took six photos on his cell phone. These things were classified. They were not marked classified, okay, but they did classify them as confidential. And anybody that's been involved in any of the military industrial complex, I worked as an engineer. I had to get confidential clearance when I was a college student doing a part-time job in the military industrial complex. And it's not very hard to get confidential security. That is a very, very low bar to set up. Okay, it is the lowest level. He had six photos that were marked confidential. He said he took these photos because he wanted to show them someday to his grandkids or whatever. They were souvenir photos, not really anything that is going to compromise national security, not like the thousands of emails that Hillary Clinton had. And so for that, he was sentenced to 1 year in prison, $100 fine, 6 months home confinement, 100 hours of community service, and a ban on owning guns. Okay? So he gets a year in prison, and he gets banned on owning guns. Meanwhile, we got Hillary Clinton, who is about to get 4 years in the White House, and she's going to ban your guns. Okay? That's how it works. That is Clinton privilege for you. Breaking the law, getting away with this, he had six confidential photos. He admitted to it. He didn't lie like Hillary Clinton. He admitted to it. And they nailed him to the wall. They said, we'd like a Clinton deal, okay? And I said, no, no, no. You're not going to get that. As one of his lawyers said, it could be argued here that depending on what your name is, that's the kind of justice you get in the United States. Yeah, it could definitely be argued that that's the case. Here's a guy, six confidential emails, okay? Hillary Clinton, not confidential emails, just pictures. Hillary Clinton had, they found, this is according to the FBI director, had eight confidentials. She had eight top secret, 36 secret, and those are just the ones that they didn't delete. We don't know how many they deleted because she got to go through and clean up her email, got to clean up her computer. This guy and his lawyers didn't get to clean up his phone, but she did, okay? That's Hillary Clinton's privilege. Join us tonight for the InfoWars Nightly News, 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern.